Scientists testify that the Bush administration interfered with their research and efforts to report on climate change data. Henry Waxman of California chairs this 3.5-hour House Oversight Committee hearing.
The first hearing we are having this year, and it focuses on one of the most important issues facing our nation and the world, global warming. Most of my colleagues know that I bring some strong views to the subject. I've been working on global warming for almost 20 years and introduced the first comprehensive global warming bill in 1992. I believed then that the science on global warming was compelling enough to warrant action. And in the years since 1992, I believe the science has grown more and more compelling. But despite my strong views, I would never want scientists to manipulate research so that they can tell me what they think I want to hear. I don't want politically correct science. I want the best science possible. And that's what today's hearing is about. For several years, there have been allegations that the research of respected climate scientists was being distorted and suppressed by the Bush administration. Some of these reports claim that Phil Cooney, a former lobbyist for the American petroleum industry, was put in charge of the Council on Environmental Quality and imposed his own views on the reports scientists had submitted to the White House. Last Congress, under the leadership of Tom Davis, this committee took the appropriate step and began investigating whether the Bush administration was interfering with the science of global warming for political reasons. I joined with Chairman Davis in requesting routine documents from the White House's Council on Environmental Quality. When the White House resisted, we narrowed our request. When the White House resisted again, we scaled back what had already been a reasonable request. And when the White House resisted a third time, we again tried to accommodate the President. In addition to repeatedly narrowing our request, we extended the deadlines we had suggested to the White House. But even after all those courtesies, we have received virtually nothing from this administration. Last evening, we finally received a total of 9 non-public documents. Unfortunately, they add little to our inquiry. In some cases, they do not even appear to be records we were seeking. It's a privilege to chair this committee. The Oversight Committee is charged with an essential responsibility, bringing accountability to our government. We take this very seriously. As chairman, I intend to be fair to every witness and to invoke the committee's broad powers only when absolutely necessary. But I also intend to be thorough, to insist on Congress's right to receive relevant information and to do everything possible to meet the important obligations we have to the American people. In this instance, the committee isn't trying to obtain state secrets or documents that could affect our immediate national security. We are simply seeking answers to whether the White House's political staff is inappropriately censoring impartial government scientists. Last fall, our staffs viewed some of the documents the committee is seeking in camera. As a result of this review, we know that the White House possesses documents that contain evidence of an attempt by senior administration officials to mislead the public by injecting doubt into the science of global warming and minimizing the potential dangers. I believe Congress is entitled to this information and to these documents. According to the documents we reviewed, administration officials sought to edit an EPA report that one to add, quote, balance, end quote, by emphasizing the, quote, beneficial effects, end quote, of climate change. Secondly, they tried to delete a discussion of the human health and environmental effects of climate change. Thirdly, to strike any discussion of atmospheric concentrations of carbon because carbon levels are not a, quote, good indicator of climate change, end quote. And four, to remove the statement that, quote, changes observed over the last several decades are likely mostly the result of human activities, end quote. Some of the most questionable edits were urged by Philip Cooney, the former oil industry lobbyist who was the chief of staff to the White House Council on Environmental Quality. Today, Ranking Member Davis and I are sending a letter to the White House about these documents to urge the White House to reconsider the confrontational approach it is now taking. I'm looking forward to hearing the testimony of today's witnesses. We are fortunate to have the Union of Concerned Scientists here and to have the opportunity to review their new report on political interference in the scientific process. I also want to welcome Dr. Drew Schindel to the committee. Dr. Schindel is a top climate researcher at NASA's Goddard Center. He will testify about the difficulties he has faced in alerting the public to his important climate research. Dr. Schindel is testifying on his own behalf today, and he's earned our gratitude for having the courage to step forward. I'd also like to note that Rick Piltz is testifying today for the first time. Mr. Piltz is the government employee who publicly objected when the Council on Environmental Quality started overruling the views of climate scientists. And we are pleased that Roger Pilkey is able to join us. All of us have a right to our own views about the seriousness of global warming, but we don't have a right to our own science. This hearing and the committee's ongoing investigation into political interference is aimed at ensuring the American people receive the best possible science. That concludes my statement, and I want to recognize Mr. Davis.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and my best wishes to you as you bring your first oversight hearing to order. I should note the irony of having a global warming hearing today on the coldest day of the year. In fact, one of my colleagues remarked, it's so cold today, the congressmen have their hands in their own pockets just to keep warm. Seriously, though, I'm pleased that our first hearing, we're continuing the committee's work on climate change. Last year, we directed the committee to address this weighty and politically charged issue in a nonpartisan way. I'm proud that we're able to strip away partisan differences to tackle an issue which most other committees had steered well clear of. Our approach earned accolades from groups like the Pew Center on Global Climate Change, which called our hearings, and I quote, some of the most balanced and informative climate change hearings in memory, and newspapers like the Washington Post, which described our work as, quote, responsible, unquote. The committee's reputation is based on its commitment to fair and responsible oversight, and I look forward to continuing that tradition with you. Mr. Chairman, I am no climate change denier. In fact, I believe it's one of the most urgent matters we face. As I've said before, there aren't many people left these days that would argue global warming isn't happening, per se. There is widespread agreement that global mean temperature has increased over the past century and that carbon dioxide in the atmosphere has contributed to this warming. Furthermore, like you, I think it's important to determine whether the administration or anyone else has attempted to quash scientific findings. That's why, together, we've requested documents from the Council on Environmental Quality and why, together, we remain disappointed in the lackluster production of those documents. But, Mr. Chairman, I'm concerned this morning that the pendulum may swing too far in the opposite direction. That is, I'm concerned that we've gone from legitimate conversations about politicizing science to a potentially dangerous dynamic that not only condones but heralds the suppression of scientific dissent. For some, it seems freedom of speech implies only to those who agree with you. And let me explain. We're seeing a dangerous trend toward inflammatory and counterproductive hyperbole. When a top climatologist at the Weather Channel calls for stripping meteorologists who express any skepticism about man's contributions to climate change of their certifications, we've probably gone too far. When so-called eco experts like skeptics to Holocaust deniers, we've definitely gone too far. This committee has earned a reputation as a truth-seeking body. We're gatherers of fact. We let the chips fall where they may. Knowledge, Mr. Chairman, is refined through continuous inquiry and, yes, through skepticism. Second, one of our witnesses will discuss this morning the issue of politicizing science, but has itself become politicized. The title of today's hearing is telling. The mere convergence of politics and science does not in itself denote interference. I would caution the committee and policymakers everywhere not to contribute to the naive notion that science and politics can somehow be kept separate. Should it really surprise anyone that leadership at federal agency manages information in pursuit of their interests or their agenda? Is the choice of phraseology, for example, climate change versus global warming, the province of science alone, or can it be allowed to reflect political as well as scientific considerations? Third, science, as we all know, evolves, living and breathing through the power of evidence. Policy needs to evolve along with it. Some in this room appear to believe we've reached the end of scientific continuum. But scientific consensus is not science. Sometimes it's nothing more than the best guess of the group that gets the microphone first. More than one strong scientific consensus of the past now lies in history's mass grave of disproved crackpots. The miasma theory of disease prevailed for a time because cholera outbreaks seemed to be associated with bad-smelling water. Less fetid water, though reduced outbreaks, apparent proof of cause and effect until the germ theory identified the real culprit. 19th century rain follows the plow theory, attributed increased rain in arid areas to increased agricultural activities by man. Today, it's understood that increased vegetation and urbanization have only limited and local effects on overall precipitation level. So in the debate about climate change attribution, determining the role of human activity on measurable climate changes, all of us, policymakers, scientists, and those fortunate enough to be neither, should take pains to maintain the healthy skepticism that is at the heart of good science and good policy. Without constant constructive doubt, both sides would have us take leaps of faith over the science to politically convenient conclusions. A wise man once wrote that science is facts. Just as houses are made of stones, so is science made of facts. But a pile of stones is not a house, and a collection of facts is not necessarily science. Mr. Chairman, I requested the documents from CEQ because I wanted to learn more about the allegations that administration officials were trying to minimize the significance of climate change. I requested them because I care about climate change and, like you, want to do something about it. I'm no denier, but I'm troubled by stories of scientists unable to publish or even complete the research because they're perceived as having the wrong answers or being on the wrong side of the science, or the leveling of accusations that rely on innuendo and inference to prove scientists' intentions is nefarious, when, in fact, often these scientists' only crime is associating with ideas that conflict with those of their accusers, or the notion that X policy action or inaction must follow from Y scientific finding. Without regard to other scientific findings or policy considerations, such as economic inhibitors or geopolitical concerns, this committee takes very seriously its responsibility for ensuring individuals remain able to speak freely. Under my chairmanship and with your leadership, Mr. Chairman, we passed hallmark whistleblower legislation, which enhanced the rights of federal whistleblowers, giving them protection and confidence as they speak up. The monumental challenge of climate change is the latest test of free speech and whistleblower protections. Again, Mr. Chairman, thank you for holding this important hearing.
Thank you very much, Mr. Davis. I'd like to ask, without objection, that we now call on members in order of seniority in which they appeared at this hearing for an opening statement, should they wish to make one, not to exceed 3 minutes. Without objection, that will be the order. And I'd also ask unanimous consent that the gentleman from Maryland, Representative Gilchrist, be permitted to participate in this hearing. In accordance with our committee practices, he'll be recognized for the purpose of an opening statement and questioning after members of the committee have been recognized. Without objection, so ordered. I want to call on Mr. Cummings. Is he here? Mr. Cummings? Okay. Well, opening statements may be submitted by any member for the record, and we'll keep the record open for that purpose. Mr. Davis, do you have an opening statement?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I shall be brief. Global warming is a serious issue and has overarching effects on our nation and our world citizenry, for we have only one Mother Earth. There is no doubt that we must take measures to look into this. We cannot and must not let politics trump science. Too much is at stake. Ask those sufferers of environmental catastrophes from an extraordinarily strong hurricane season, most notably Katrina, to families who are victims of sound pesticide regulation, whose children have suffered from the adverse effects on brain development in fetuses and children. Numerous well-regarded and credible scientists have issued reports with regards to climate change and its far-reaching consequences, and any effort by the White House Council on Environmental Quality to alter or undermine the integrity of such fact-finding is detrimental. We must take into full account the sound scientific evidence that some of our best minds have to offer and begin to comprehensively treat this problem immediately. Ask the thousands of rescue workers in the World Trade Center who were told by the EPA that the air was safe. Imagine what would happen if political tampering of scientific data is acceptable. This proclamation appears to be premature as our nation's heroes are now plagued by chronic and crippling long ailments. There are grave consequences from such action. And again, I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member Tom Davis, for holding this hearing today. It is long overdue, and I look forward to the expert panel of witnesses who've come to share with us, and I yield back any additional time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Davis. Mr. Shays?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Quickly, I want to say climate change and global warming are one and the same for me. When the President submitted, President Clinton was negotiating the Kyoto Agreement, the Senate 100-0 said don't exclude China and India. The treaty came back excluding China and India, and there were only about 5 members of the Senate who supported it. My big regret, and the President Clinton never asked for a vote in the Senate, my big regret is that President Bush, whatever his feelings were about the treaty, should have submitted it to the Senate for its consideration without prejudice, because I believe, frankly, that there would have been less than 20 members of the Senate who would have supported the treaty, but now it's like all of them would have. And I just conclude by saying that anyone who alters scientific research, particularly on issues as important as this, should quit or should be fired. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Shays. Mr. Tierney?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll submit my remarks for the record. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Clay?
Thank you, Chairman Waxman and Ranking Member Davis, for holding today's hearing. I welcome our witnesses and commend Mr. Pilts and Dr. Shindell on their courage in coming before this committee to testify about their experiences with the Bush administration's policy of misrepresenting global warming data for political reasons. It is apparent that you are both committed to fully disclosing the facts about global warming. It is imperative that the integrity of scientific research on global warming is ensured and that we do everything possible to give our children and our grandchildren a healthy environment. Reports that scientists working for federal agencies have been asked to change data to fit policy initiatives are seriously disturbing, and given the enormous health risk posed by global warming, it is unconscionable that any scientist would participate in such a dangerous plan. Emerging threats to health from climate change include malaria, Lyme disease, and an alarming increase in asthma incidences in the U.S. The American Public Health Association found that smog, increased pollen, and carbon dioxide are fostering an epidemic of asthma in America's cities. The highest incidence of asthma in the U.S. is among African-American toddlers and low-income toddlers. Inner-city children are most at risk for getting asthma due to poor air quality, increasing temperatures, and the high concentration of carbon dioxide. Political appointees have no business distorting the facts or denying the realities of global warming. Global warming is not a myth or a distant threat. It is a reality that demands immediate action from our government. We must implement policies to develop more renewable energy resources, to drastically reduce automobile emissions, and to end our dependence on oil and other fossil fuels. Unfortunately, the Bush administration has shown a blatant disregard for the health of the American people. They have shown they would rather safeguard the interest of big oil than preserve the future of planet Earth. This administration has not only failed to address the assault on climate change, they have contributed to this crisis. Global warming poses an overwhelming challenge to our responsibility to protect the Earth for future generations. I look forward to today's testimony and working with my colleagues to meet this challenge and to put an end to this administration's efforts to deny or undermine scientific knowledge about the global warming crisis. Mr. Chairman, I yield back the balance of my time and submit my statement for the record.
Thank you, Mr. Clay. Mr. Cannon?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There is some feedback happening on our mic system, I think. Or am I the only one hearing that? It would really be nice to correct that if we have somebody available to do that.
We have people working on it. Let me just ask if all members have their mics off, in case any mic is on that might be causing it.
You know, Mr. Chairman, my mic, when it's off, still works. So the switch is, I'm not sure if we've got a more fundamental problem here.
You ought to be careful what you say when your mic's presumably
off. It might be
off.
Me.
Well, we'll make the best of it. We have our best people working on trying to correct the problem.
One would hope that those would be at least of the quality of some of the climate change scientists we have in the world today. I wanted to thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this hearing, and also associate myself with the remarks of the ranking member and Mr. Shays. The fact is this: I believe there is global warming, and therefore it's a global problem, not just an American problem. And on the other hand, I think there's some serious question as to whether or not global warming is actually caused by man, or how much of global warming is caused by man. What a relief. We can now think. This is all a plot to distort the thinking of our panel members, I'm sure. I would like to submit a statement for the record, Mr. Chairman, and not belabor this, but point out that science is by nature, especially when science needs to be funded, it is political. And suppression happens all over the place, and unfortunately suppression is complicated by bad science done by not very smart scientists who have an agenda that is more a matter of belief or emotion than it is clarity of thinking. And so in this whole process, I hope we come to be able to distinguish between what is an agenda and what is science, and what is the data, and how do we draw conclusions from that data. With that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Cannon. Mr. Cannon, now we go to Ms. Watson.
I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman, for convening today's hearing and your timeliness on this issue. The United States has only 2% of the world's oil reserves, but accounts for 25% of the world's energy demand. Of the global supply, we consume 43% of motor gasoline, 25% of crude petroleum, 25% of natural gas, and 25% of electricity. Currently, American demand for all these commodities is rising dramatically. The administration announced in 2002 that reducing greenhouse emissions and increasing spending on climate research to reduce emission 18% by 2012 was a top priority. But their actions have not matched this pledge. Funds have been redirected for these purposes to spend on nuclear power and other non-renewable programs that do not reduce emissions. In addition, the allegation of political interference with the work of government scientists is an additional example of how this administration is not taking the threat of global warming seriously. Global warming is occurring at a rapid pace today, and the consensus of the worldwide scientific community is that it would accelerate during the 21st century. Global warming and our related energy policies also raise national security concerns. One such concern is the prospect of international destabilization caused by the consequences of global warming, such as the loss of land area or the loss of water resources. Mr. Chairman, as I have stated in previous hearings on this issue, we have a chance to start again to create adequate climate change research and develop that we can help our world in the future. Political interference on this critical issue is unacceptable. We all live under the same skies, and we are here today to investigate and resolve these allegations, and politics has no place in science. Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and I yield back the rest of my time.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Watson. Mr. Duncan?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Richard Lindzen, who is a professor of atmospheric science at MIT, a few months ago wrote in the Wall Street Journal about what he called the alarmism and feeding frenzy surrounding the climate change global warming debate. And he said this, he said, quote, "But there is a more sinister side to this feeding frenzy. Scientists who dissent from the alarmism have seen their grant funds, their work derided, and themselves libeled as industry stooges, scientific hacks, or worse. Consequently, lies about climate change gain credence even when they fly in the face of the science that supposedly is their basis." Professor David Deming, a geophysicist, said, quote, "The media hysteria on global warming has been generated by journalists who don't understand the provisional and uncertain nature of scientific knowledge. Science changes." Robert Bradley, president of the Institute for Energy Research, wrote this. He said in the Washington Times, he said, "The emotional, politicized debate over global warming has produced a fire-ready aim mentality despite great and still growing scientific uncertainty about the problem." And he went on to say, he said, "Still, climate alarmists demand a multitude of do-somethings to address a problem they are sure exists and is solvable. They pronounce the debate over in their favor and call their critics names such as deniers, as in Holocaust deniers. This has created a bad climate for scientific research and for policymaking. In fact, the debate is more than unsettled." So I appreciate you calling this hearing. This issue has become very politicized and emotional. It appears that most of those who support and say most of the alarmists about global warming are people who are funded directly or indirectly by the federal government. So we need to look into these things and see what the real truth is in this situation. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you for your comments. Mr. Lynch?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you to the ranking member for holding this hearing. I'm going to submit my official remarks in the interest of time to the record, but I do want to say thank you to the panelists for coming before this committee and helping us with our work. And with all due respect to my colleague who spoke previously, this is not a hearing on alarmism or the quality and integrity of the information that has been delivered to the Congress and to the White House by the scientific community. This is a hearing that will investigate allegations that attorneys, not scientists, attorneys formerly employed by the American Petroleum Institute, edited scientific documents that were meant to alert the public and alert the Congress to the effects of global warming. This is a hearing that will look into whether or not that data, that information, that scientific information that we would rely upon was distorted by this White House. That's what we're investigating here. And we appreciate the courage of the panelists that have stepped forward to help Congress in making that decision. This is very troubling, not only in the sense that scientific data had been distorted and there had been an attempt to misinform the American people, but also the concerted pattern and practice of this White House to censor these scientists has a chilling effect, not only on these individuals, but on a wider scientific community. So we're here to exercise the right of the American people to get the truth. That's what we're here for today. It's not to debate the degree to which the atmosphere is warming or the extent to which global warming will impact us over the coming years and decades. This is really a question about governmental integrity and whether we are partners with our scientific community to protect the interests not only of the American people, but our partners around the world. And I appreciate that this chairman has had the courage to put this issue right out in front. It's the first hearing of this committee, and I think it sends a great message to the American people and to the scientific community that the work that they do is greatly appreciated and welcomed by this Congress. With that, Mr. Chairman, I'll yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Lynch. Mr. Issa? Mr. Issa?
I think he stepped out.
Oh, he stepped out. Then we'll go to Ms. Fox.
Who else can he want to speak?
Mr. Platts, are you? Mr. Gilchrist, okay.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Just a very brief comment that's a little off topic, but it sort of is relevant to this issue of whether or not there's enough scientific evidence to display from the administration or anybody else that there is human activity causing the climate to change. I would urge my colleagues to contact National Geographic. They have a genographic program where they've converged anthropologists and geneticists to see where your ancestors came from, and I participated in that, gave my DNA, and the markers of my DNA went from here to Ireland, to Spain, all the way to Ethiopia about 50,000 years ago. The way they were able to do that, and by the way, I spent about 5,000 years in Iran about 35,000 years ago before they migrated further west. The point is that there's DNA markers in human DNA that can actually be traced over millenniums back thousands and tens of thousands of years. If we converge those two sciences, anthropology and geneticists, if we do the same thing with the atmosphere, we converge meteorologists, atmospheric scientists, with chemists and a variety of other people, you can trace the markers in CO2 or methane or any one of the other atmospheric gases back not thousands of years, but millions of years. And when you look at those markers, those radioactive isotopes, 800,000 years ago to just today, you can tell where the CO2 comes from. Does it come from a volcano? Does it come from soybeans? Does it come from burning forest that all produces CO2? The markers, the distinctive markers, burning gasoline produces a marker in the CO2 that's different from the marker in CO2 coming out of volcanoes. The point is there's an extraordinary amount of science that an individual, member of Congress, for example, pursuing an objective analysis, can make a fairly quick determination by talking to a variety of interest in the scientific community to, yes, determine that the natural range of fluctuation has been disrupted in the last 100 years to produce a huge increase in CO2 from burning fossil fuel, and the markers are present there. Is science 100%? There's a principle of uncertainty that's been in the scientific community for quite some time, and the principle of uncertainty is that science is always working on the edge of the unknown. So a sense of tolerance to that result by us, I think, is pretty vital. And I really appreciate the fact that the chairman and the ranking members are holding this hearing today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gilchrist. Mr. Higgins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have no opening statement. I thank you for calling this hearing, and I look forward to the testimony of the expert panel that you've assembled.
Thank you. Mr. Braley?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
For an opening statement?
Gentleman's recognized.
Mr. Chairman and Mr. Davis, it is a pleasure for me to join this distinguished committee. I look forward to serving with you as we do what we have been charged with, to examine fairly and honestly government programs, contracts, and expenditures. Today we begin these activities in the new Congress by reviewing the administration's actions with respect to the study of global climate change. But as all of us know, the issue before us is not really climate change itself. It's whether the Bush administration has manipulated facts, prevented scientific investigation, or otherwise obstructed honest study of this critical issue. Now, Mr. Chairman, I must say that the idea the administration has stifled inquiry and action is a bit hard for me to swallow. From 2001 through 2006, this administration devoted more than $25 billion to programs related to climate change, $25 billion. Where I'm from in Idaho, that's a pretty good chunk of change. In addition, in 2003 and 2004 alone, in part due to the administration policies, U.S. greenhouse gas intensity dropped by about 4.5%. And in the 2005 energy bill, the administration obtained $5 billion in tax incentives over a five-year period for what it calls, and I'm quoting, quote, clean energy systems and highly efficient vehicles, mandatory renewable fuel, and energy efficiency standards. The Bush administration's Advanced Energy Initiative is increasing by 22% Department of Energy research funding to help refine clean energy technologies to the point that they can be used effectively and at a modest price by ordinary Americans. Mr. Chairman, these actions are not the hallmarks of an administration that is seeking to curtail research or force certain results. President Bush and his team are committed to serious, effective, and practical research and action. They put a lot of federal money where the public commitments have been made, a lot of money. This administration has been working to safeguard our resources, reduce greenhouse gas emissions, and at the same time help American manufacturing and mining and metal industries remain strong and competitive in the global marketplace. To cripple our industrial sector in the name of environmental quality is not good public policy or good science. It's mere ideology, zealotry in the name of environmental extremism. The Bush administration has taken a much more balanced course, and I applaud it. Mr. Chairman, I am concerned with the tenor of this hearing, with the general approach that we will be taking in the next 2 years. I believe in oversight, in asking hard questions, and in demanding appropriate accountability. But today's hearing seems less about finding answers than making an argument. I hope that perception is incorrect. However, if it is accurate, I hope it is not a foretaste of a partisan contention that will be cloaked as oversight. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Braley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Ranking Member Davis, for giving us the opportunity to discuss these important issues today. And with all respect to my distinguished colleague from Idaho, I think that one of the biggest problems that we have right now with the Bush administration is captured in this Congress Daily AM headline, panel steamed over withheld documents, which focuses on respect for the rule of law, respect for the jurisdiction of this committee, and the deliberate withholding of information requested over a six-month period in a bipartisan spirit, not just by this committee chair, but by the former chair and the ranking member. And that sets a tone that I think should cause us all concern about the impact that the administration is having on the conduct of oversight in this Congress. I have a portrait in my office of one of my heroes, Clarence Darrow, someone who stood up for the integrity of the scientific inquiry and academic freedom, and stood up for accountability and the rule of fact over fiction. I had the great privilege of graduating from the Iowa State University of Science and Technology, where the first digital computing system was invented. And one of the things I know is that people who work in an academic environment need to have assurances that their inquiries will be free from political influence. That's what distinguishes us from other countries around the world and gives us the opportunity to make great advances as we have seen over the entire history of this country. One of the things I also know is that the federal court system has set up a gatekeeping system to make sure that testimony presented in a court of law has the credibility of scientific inquiry behind it. And things like making sure that those scientific theories have been tested through peer-reviewed journals is an indication of what stands for academic freedom, stands for preservation of the integrity of the scientific process in the free marketplace of ideas. We need to get back to that system. We need to diminish the role of politics so that our scientists have the ability to give us the great discoveries we've come to depend upon them in making this country the place that it is. So I look forward to working with the committee, and I also want to comment on how much appreciation I have for our witnesses today. I know what it's like to represent clients who have sat in your shoes. It doesn't take a lot of courage to sit back here and make comments and ask questions. It takes a tremendous amount of courage to sit where you are, and we appreciate your willingness to come and share your thoughts with us. I yield back the remainder of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Braley. Mr. Issa?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And I, too, want to echo earlier remarks that this has been a committee that on a bipartisan basis has been frustrated by an inability, not just in this area, but in a number of areas, to get the kind of candid response and respect for the oversight responsibility of the Congress. I certainly hope today that this hearing will deal with the facts as to whether or not oversight is going to be properly done and respected in the future. And I say so for a couple of reasons. First of all, I think that the people out in the hinterland watching this, and even the people in the gallery here today, understand that global warming is not a secret hidden from the American people by the government. Certainly, Mr. Sally said it very well. There have been huge amounts of money, huge amounts of awareness as to global warming. There is a debate going on as to what part the human being plays in it and how much of it is simply us coming out of a mini ice age. And I believe good science should be used, employed, paid for, and deliver us answers so that we can make intelligent decisions. Additionally, this committee in the last Congress spent a lot of time through our oversight and hearings realizing that CO2 was only going to be beat by non-CO2 products, which includes nuclear, a subject that often is by the same people who insist on ending global warming, is also rejected. So I'm hoping that we can do that and more. I do recognize that this is a highly charged political subject, but it is my sincere hope that this committee will continue working on a bipartisan basis to recognize that as presidents come and go, as Congresses change from one side to the other side, having the chairman's gavel, that this committee has an ongoing responsibility. We take it seriously, and we expect to get answers to our questions from whoever occupies the Oval Office, or more specifically, by the bureaucrats who stay there throughout one administration after another and tend to resist. And that is what we're here, I hope, today to do, is to recognize that it's time for us to assert our oversight role and insist on it. With that, I yield back and thank the chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Issa. Ms. Norton?
Mr. Chairman, I thank you for this hearing, but I'm sure that millions of Americans thank you for this hearing, and I appreciate that you have made this your first hearing. So far as I know, it is the first hearing on global warming to be held in the House this session. And I know you have not simply gone down a list and picked this one out. This issue, the fate of the planet itself, simply has no rival in importance. Because the issue has somehow in our country become controversial, not sure that is true in most advanced countries, such a hearing might be perceived as blame-laying. But the reason for this hearing for Congress is surely to make sure that actions are taken and that information is not ever again suppressed. We need to be full speed ahead on this one. The elements that comprise global warming had a huge head start on this hearing. Mr. Chairman, the independence of church and state is gospel in our country. Well, the independence of science from politics ought to be the same in government. We got the best science in the world. Its word has always been its bond. When we consider the dangers to public health and to the planet itself, the politicization of science is itself a catastrophe that simply must be avoided. Apparently, there had been one peer study over against the hundreds that said there wasn't global warming. But this administration chose the side
with those who said no. There were no nuances apparent in its view. At the moment, the administration is defending in the Supreme Court of the United States the position that CO2 is not covered by the Clean Air Act. Without getting into the technicalities, that takes a huge stretch if you know anything about the act. Now the courts have to decide the issue. And if I know the courts, they will try to find some procedural way to avoid a scientific issue that shouldn't be there and shouldn't be in politics at all. We do not have the luxury, Mr. Chairman, of making up for lost time on this one. We have done that historically, disregard the losses. There'll be more where that came from. Already, my great fear is that it is too late when you see glaciers melting. I know of no science that is likely to refreeze the glaciers or to reproduce their majesty. Mr. Chairman, I live in hope, and only hope it is not already too late, as I thank you again for this hearing.
Thank you very much, Ms. Norton. Ms. McCollum?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your leadership on this important issue. I'd also like to express my appreciation to the witnesses with us here today for their efforts in calling attention to the disturbing pattern of interference and abuse of science surrounding global climate change. I applaud each of you for having the courage to have your voice heard. In my home state of Minnesota, we are uniquely affected by changing climate patterns because of our geography. We are at the intersection of three major ecosystems. Minnesota and Minnesotans are experiencing the effects of climate change, and my constituents are demanding action. Global climate change is one of the greatest challenges facing this nation. We know that meaningful solutions will demand unprecedented cooperation, innovation, commitment, and urgency. Over the past 6 years, enormous scientific consensus supporting the reality of global climate change did not fit the administration's agenda. As we have seen in other situations, when reality doesn't fit the script, the White House rewrites reality to fit the script. Tragically, the Bush administration has led an effort to suppress and distort the science of global warming, while providing protection and ensuring massive profits for the petroleum industry. Is this why the Bush administration feels so threatened by the issue of climate change that it engages in a calculated campaign to manipulate scientific documents and intimidate science? What justification does the administration give us for these actions? Congress has the responsibility and the duty to find the answers as to why the administration officials acted as they did. But the impacts of the administration's interference with the science of global climate change are already known. It has undermined the integrity of numerous federal agencies. It has recklessly harmed the careers of many respected professionals. It has delayed popular consensus on the need to take action against global warming. I fear America will look back on the Bush administration as the lost years, lost talent, lost time, lost solutions. While there is a need for science in the realm of political debate, we must fiercely guard against the intrusion of politics into scientific research and discovery. And that's why today's hearing is an essential first step. Through transparency, we will find accountability. Through accountability, we will create a new and higher standard, one in which science is required and the science that is given to the American people is correct and accurate. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much, Ms. McCollum. Mr. Cooper.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First, for the record, I'd like to take note of a recent book called The Republican War on Science by Chris Mooney. It's excellent reading. I can't help but note it has a blurb on the back from our distinguished chairman recommending that people read it. Second, let me mention a dinner party I attended about 2 months ago here in Washington. The honoree was John Negroponte, who was then the Director of National Intelligence. He was there to receive an environmental award. It was very interesting because in anticipation of his remarks, word slipped through the crowd that he was not allowed to utter the words global warming. at least not in the same sentence. Apparently, he was allowed to say the word global in a separate sentence and warming in a separate sentence, but not together. So it became a little parlor game during his remarks to see how closely he would fit the words global and warming and not incur the wrath of the White House. I thought this was a sad statement of the current condition of our scientific community when a top and very eminent statesman like John Negroponte would be so hamstrung by the administration that he would not be allowed to utter the two words in conjunction. I thought that was an indignity to Mr. Negroponte and a sad comment on the level of the Bush administration to so hamstring its talented and capable appointees. Sadly, this is an effort on the part of the administration that's been going on for a long time. Another must-read book is by Christine Todd Whitman, the former EPA administrator, entitled It's My Party Too. In this book, she chronicles how President Bush promised in the campaign to do something about carbon emissions, then reversed his promise at the urging of four Republican senators who are named in the book, Chuck Hagel, Jesse Helms, Larry Craig, and Pat Roberts. This reversal took place while Christy Todd Whitman was negotiating on behalf of the United States in Trieste in Europe. So before she flew back, her legs were completely cut out from underneath her, embarrassing America and undercutting science in our community. And this is not a Democratic diatribe. This is a Bush cabinet official's memoirs. What a sad condition our country has fallen into. But I commend the scientists who have testified today. I'm sorry I was not able to be here for your entire testimony, but I look forward to reading it in detail. I thank the chair.
Thank you, Mr. Cooper. Mr. Hodes?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for calling this hearing. In New Hampshire, we talk a lot about the weather. And folks where I come from notice that the weather is changing. We don't have a lot of snow this year. But we're not here to talk about the weather, and we're not here to talk about money spent or unspent. We're here to investigate rank political abuse. We live in an information age when we as a nation and as global citizens face rapidly changing climatic conditions. The integrity of scientific research is critical to wise policymaking. Before coming to Congress, I read numerous articles documenting concerns about the interference by the Bush administration with the conclusions of government scientists. Allowing politics to trump science is dangerous business. Disinformation was once thought of as a fictional Orwellian construct. If it has happened here, we need to bring it out in the open and help restore good scientific practices without fear of retaliation, reprisal, and control by political officials. The American people need good data and good science, not disinformation, if we are to effectively address global warming and make the right policy decisions. We need science unimpeded by political concerns. I thank the panelists for appearing. It takes courage to come and tell the truth, but the American people want it, they need it, and as members of Congress, we expect it. So thank you very much. I yield back. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you for your statement. Mr. Murphy?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, on my walk to the Capitol this morning, I passed a line of cherry trees that up until a few weeks ago had been blooming. And frankly, the sight of a cherry tree in the middle of winter blooming concerns me and a lot of us very deeply. I know why the tree was blooming. The high temperature on the 1st of December was 75 degrees. The high on the 6th of January was 70 degrees and 67 on the 15th. Now, whether this is an anomaly of the season or a sign of a trend, I don't know, but today it feels like winter, and I'm pretty relieved. There's unequivocal scientific evidence that the Earth is warming due to human activities, specifically to the release of carbon dioxide emissions in the air. One would think that given these facts, the President would appoint someone amongst the talented pool of scientists in this country to look into the question. But proving once again that this President never misses an opportunity to miss an opportunity, who does he appoint? a lawyer with no scientific training, a former oil industry lobbyist whose primary responsibility on certain days seemed to be disproving the link between greenhouse gases and the companies he was representing. If you look at the EPA's website on climate change, you'll read, quote, that a causal link between the buildup of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere and the observed climate change during the 20th century cannot be unequivocally established, unquote. Given the data that this committee, Mr. Chairman, has uncovered into the Bush administration's political interference in the scientific community, we should not be surprised. I thank the panel for having the courage to be here with us today. I look forward to your testimony, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you very much. Mr. Sarbanes?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you for holding this hearing today on the science of global climate change. This is the first substantive hearing I've had the opportunity to participate in as a newly elected member of this body, and I believe the subject matter could not be more appropriate. In my own state of Maryland, and especially within the 3rd Congressional District, we have a strong tradition of environmental advocacy, rooted in a passion for the Chesapeake Bay. But the Chesapeake Bay, which is our nation's largest estuary, has not escaped the consequences of global warming. In fact, as a result of global warming, sea levels in the Chesapeake Bay area have risen at alarming levels over the last 100 years. If continued unchecked, this phenomenon will cause entire Bay Islands to be submerged and destroy diverse plant and wildlife habitat across the Bay watershed. Such a calamity would have a profound environmental and ecological impact, but would also devastate Maryland's tourism and seafood industries. The scope of the challenge of global warming is international, but its impact on people and communities can be seen in how it has affected areas like the Chesapeake Bay region. Likewise, change must begin by examining our own personal behaviors and our own national energy policy, which overwhelmingly depends on fossil fuels. Promoting change will be difficult, however, if the administration continues its systematic effort to understate the threat of global warming. Mr. Chairman, effective and responsible governance at all levels depends on receiving accurate and timely information. All too often, this administration has disregarded or, in some cases, suppressed information that does not support its particular ideological or political agenda. We have seen this pattern in the run-up to the Iraq War, in the crafting of the Medicare prescription drug legislation, and, as is being demonstrated today, in the approach to global climate change. Today's hearing marks the beginning of a march back to fact-based decision-making at the highest levels of our government. Mr. Chairman, thank you for your efforts to illuminate the true science of global climate change. I look forward to working with my colleagues to address this problem in a meaningful way. Today's hearing is not just about preserving our natural climate. It's about preserving the climate for open and honest scientific research and discussion. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Sarbanes. Mr. Welch?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For decades, the issue of climate change has focused on debate about science. And today, the overwhelming scientific research shows that global warming is real, it's urgent, and it requires immediate action. That consensus has not always been present, with only a shrinking minority remaining as skeptics. But more often than not, that skepticism has been driven by politics or economic motivations, not the facts. And we've learned that outspoken scientists, dedicated to following the facts where they lead, have had their sound conclusions altered by those motivated by politics, not the truth. And scientists at the 7 agencies that studied climate change have reported such widespread abuses. Politically motivated suppression of science is not only irresponsible, but highlights a careless and reckless disregard for the public that all of us are here to serve. We have an opportunity to investigate that because it's critically important to our future. The true test of leadership for scientists, for people in politics, is an ability to face directly the realities that are oftentimes difficult. To help us do that, we need honest scientific conclusions. and I applaud the gentlemen who are here today to testify and provide us with their best scientific evidence. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield the balance of my time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Welch. Mr. Yarmouth?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm anxious to hear the witnesses, so I would like to submit my prepared remarks for the record. But I'd just like to add that one thing I think we all can agree on is that in the area of global climate change, the government, the federal government, has a critical role to play, and therefore, when it speaks, it has to speak with complete authority and credibility, and that can only be achieved if it is unduly influenced by personal political agendas or by the agenda of special interests. So I think these hearings can contribute to a large extent to creating that degree of credibility when the government does speak on climate change, and I commend the chairman for organizing these hearings. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Yarmouth. Mr. Kucinich?
I thank the chair for holding this hearing, and one has to ask, do you have to be a scientist to know that there's something quite unusual going on with our global climate? You have to be a member of Congress to understand it? All over the world, people have seen the effects of global climate change. The intensity of storms, the frequency of droughts, the destruction of crops, rising sea levels, changes in migration patterns. I don't need a scientist to tell me this is happening because I see it myself. But the problem comes when you get scientists who tell you something that's different from what you're seeing with your own eyes. Why do we even get trapped into that type of thinking? Remember the long parade of witnesses who used to come in front of congressional committees generations ago and put TV commercials on the air that would tell people smoking was good for them? It's glamorous, sexy. That was backed by science. Today we have a planet that's smoking. And we're told that, don't worry, be happy. And yet we have seen scientific evidence presented and then subverted by this administration. We paid for the scientific studies. And then when the studies come forward, they're dismissed. We're not even getting what we're paying for. We're all citizens of the same planet, at least we would hope we are. We have a common destiny. We should share common concerns about the stability of the global climate and act to protect our planet. We need to challenge the type of thinking which separates us from our natural environment. Almost 30 years ago, a philosopher by the name of Morris Berman wrote a book called The Reenchantment of the World, who talked about the fundamental problem which comes from when human beings separate themselves from the very environment in which they breathe in, which they drink in. That type of thinking, that us versus them type of thinking, that dichotomous type thinking, not only separates us from each other, but it is a precursor of war itself. So this hearing becomes important when we understand our common aspirations to aspire to a stable global climate, about our common concerns, which should be expressed, about great fluctuations in temperatures and irregular weather patterns. And these changes in weather patterns, the more intense storms, including hurricanes, Hurricane Katrina, ought to cause us to seek out scientists who are free to give us their best advice. There's substantial scientific certainty about climate change. Scientists are confident that global warming is happening. The vast majority of experts on the issue agree that human activities are to blame. I mean, this is a call for leadership which unites the American people in taking a new direction for not just energy conservation, but in the development of alternative energies, green energies. But what happens is, because scientific information is brought forward which disputes global climate change, the kind of massive unity that we need to take a new direction is slowed. So I thank the chair for holding this hearing and for his consistent leadership over the years to reclaim human dignity. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Unfortunately, one of the glitches of this hearing today is that that green light seems to be on forever, even if the time has expired. So we'll try to work that out, but at least we stopped the static.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Everywhere I go in life, there's a green light, so I appreciate that.
To close out the opening statements, I want to call on the gentleman from Maryland, Mr. Van Hollen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for your leadership in this very important issue. I think we can all agree that everybody's entitled to their own opinions, but not everybody's entitled to their own facts. And we as a nation invest billions of dollars every year in scientific research, whether it's at NIH, whether it's EPA, whether it's at NOAA, and that's an investment made by the taxpayers. And that investment is only as good as the reliability of the science that comes from that investment. And that's why it's essential that the science that we do as a federal government is done free from political interference. Because if facts become twisted by the politics, then that's money wasted, taxpayer money wasted. And I am afraid that over the past many years, we have seen that kind of political interference. We all know political science is sort of one realm of inquiry. Under this administration, unfortunately, much more of science has become political science. And it's not just in the area of global climate change, although that has been Exhibit A. And here on Capitol Hill, the tone with respect to that debate was set by people like one of our colleagues on the Senate side who used to chair the Senate Environment and Public Works Committee, Senator Inhofe, who said, and I quote, "Global warming is the greatest hoax ever perpetuated on the American people." And this Congress in the past and the administration helped set the tone at the top that was placed over our scientists, our public servants, who do this work day by day trying to get at the right answers. And the result has been a twisting of the science, not just in the area of global climate change. The Government Reform Committee looked at this question when it came to mercury control and regulations. In fact, the Inspector General, the Independent Inspector General at the EPA, found just more than a year ago that there had been interference through the political process on the science of mercury poisoning, the development of regulations in that area. So this has been a problem endemic from the top in this administration. And I represent a lot of federal employees. I happen to represent a district that includes the NIH, that includes NOAA, that includes the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, many others. Those are good people who are just trying to do their work and get at the facts and get the science for the benefit of the American people. And I can tell you, when I'm able to talk to them one-on-one, when the political minders are not around, they tell me about the chilling effect from the top on the work that they're done and on the influence that is brought to bear from the top on their work. And I think it's high time that we had a thaw in that chilling influence. And I think this hearing and this new day on Capitol Hill is part of setting that new tone. Science should be fact-driven. We should not be driven by the political vagaries of any administration, whether it be Republican or Democrat. And so I think that that is the message that we want to send to the good people in our government who are working every day on behalf of the American people to get the answers. And Mr. Chairman, let me just close on this. Yesterday evening, we had a hearing in Montgomery County, a bipartisan hearing on legislation that's been proposed in the Congress on mental health and the insurance coverage for mental health. Congressman Patrick Kennedy and Congressman Jim Ramstad, Democrat, Republican, have been going around the country on this issue. We invited a member, a representative from the National Institutes of Mental Health to testify, and that individual wanted to testify. 2 weeks ago was preparing testimony. We asked them only for their testimony on the science, mental health issue, the science of the brain. We weren't asking them to take a position on the legislation. We wanted to hear about the science. They were prepared to come. Yesterday, just before we had the hearing, they were notified by their political minders at NIH that they could not come to a hearing attended by members of Congress, Republicans and Democrats alike. It seems to me, if the people of this country are making the kind of investment they are at NIH, that we should be able to have the benefit of their testimony. Whether that's hearing is held here in the United States Congress by members of committee or in our districts, especially when the representatives from NIH is an expert in the field and leader in the field and was eager to testify. And it's just another example, it seems to me, of the politics getting in the way of allowing our public servants to inform the public about the best results from their scientific inquiry. So thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this hearing. I thank the witnesses for being here.
Thank you, Mr. Van Hollen. I want to thank all the members for their opening statements, and we're now going to hear from the witnesses who have been described as courageous, but I also want to describe them as patient. Let me introduce the witnesses. We have Dr. Francesca Griffo, Senior Scientist and Director of the Union of Concerned Scientists Scientific Integrity Program. She has over 20 years of experience directing science-based projects and programs. She holds a PhD in botany from Cornell University. Rick Pilz is the Director of Climate Science Watch, a program that aims to hold public officials accountable for using climate research with integrity and effectiveness in addressing the challenge of global climate change. From April 1995 until March 2005, Mr. Pilz worked at the U.S. Climate Change Science Program, where he coordinated scientific research on climate change. Dr. Drew Schindel is an atmospheric physicist who studies climate change and atmospheric chemistry. He's worked at NASA's Goddard Institute for Space Studies for the last 12 years. In 2004, Scientific American magazine named Dr. Schindel one of the top 50 scientists in the country. And Dr. Roger Pilkey is a political scientist who has been on the faculty of the University of Colorado since 2001. He is a professor in the Environmental Studies Program and a fellow of the Cooperative Institute for Research in the Environmental Sciences. It's our practice in this committee to swear in all witnesses, so if you would please rise, I'd like to administer the oath. Do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Record will note that each witness answered in the affirmative. I would like to ask each of the witnesses to give a brief summary of their testimony, to keep this summary under 5 minutes duration. Unfortunately, that light may not tell you when the 5 minutes is up, but I will let you know when the 5 minutes is up, and then we would appreciate a concluding statement. Your written testimony that has been submitted in advance will be made part of the record in full. We thank you for being here, and Dr. Griffo, why don't we start with you? There's a button on the base of the mic you need to turn on to activate the mic.
Yep, it's on. Good morning, and thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, for the opportunity to be here and address you. I come representing the Union of Concerned Scientists and scientists across the country. Political interference is harming federal science and threatening the health and safety of Americans. Over 1,800 federal scientists from multiple agencies have reported concerns. 699 scientists, that's 39% of our respondents across 9 agencies, have reported that they fear retaliation for openly expressing their concerns about mission-driven work of their agencies. 432 scientists from 5 agencies reported that they were not able to publish work in peer-reviewed journals if it did not adhere to agency policies. That was 25% of our respondents. And from the report we are releasing today, 150 federal climate scientists report personally experiencing at least one incident of political interference in the past 5 years, for a total of at least 435 incidents. All branches of government must have access to independent scientific advice. The thousands of scientists in the employ of the federal government represent a tremendous resource. We need strong action to restore integrity to federal science in order to be prepared to face the complex challenges ahead of us. The Union of Concerned Scientists has documented scores of examples of such abuses in our online A to Z guide to political interference in science. This interference can take many forms, from censorship and suppression of federal science to dissemination of inaccurate scientific results and science-based information to the manipulation of scientific advice. Over 11,000 scientists, including 52 Nobel laureates and numerous other luminaries and science advisors to both Republican and Democratic presidents dating back to the Eisenhower administration, have signed our statement calling for a restoration of scientific integrity. Our investigations demonstrate that the problem goes deeper than just the high-profile incidents and includes new examples from NOAA and NASA, as well as the voices of hundreds of climate scientists from seven federal agencies. Our investigations found high-quality science struggling to get out. Nearly half of all respondents perceived or personally experienced pressure to eliminate the words climate change, global warming, or other similar terms from a variety of communications. 43% personally experienced or perceived changes or edits during the review of documents that change the meaning of scientific findings. Barriers to communication hinder our national ability to prepare and respond to protect future generations from the consequences of global warming. Our investigation uncovered numerous examples of public affairs officers at federal agencies taking an active role in regulating communications between agency scientists and the media, in effect serving as gatekeepers for scientific information. We found agency climate scientists who had their press inquiries routed to other scientists whose views more closely matched administration policy, and who routinely encounter difficulty in obtaining approval for official press releases. Two-thirds of respondents said that today's environment for federal government climate research is worse compared with 5 years ago and 10 years ago. Both scientists and journalists report that restrictive media policies and practices have hampered the communication between government scientists and the news media. This limits the extent to which new scientific findings can enter the public and policy debate. The report includes a model media policy which encompasses the following: whistleblower protections. Congress must act to protect scientists who speak out when they see interference or suppression of science, and all agency policies must affirmatively educate their employees of their rights under these statutes. Scientific freedoms. Federal scientists have a constitutional right to speak about any subject, so long as the scientists make clear that they do so in their private capacity. Scientists must also have a right of last review on agency communications related to their research. Scientific openness. Scientists should not be subject to restrictions on media contacts beyond a policy of informing public affairs officials in advance of an interview and summarizing the interaction for them afterwards. Federal agencies should support the free exchange of scientific information in all venues. And I just want to close with a quote from a NASA scientist from our survey. Civil service scientists and engineers can and should be an unbiased reservoir of insights into different questions. If we can't be trusted to give insights on global change and funded to do so, who in the world will do it? Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Before calling on Mr. Pilt, I understand that in order to get the timer to register on the front table, there needs to be an adjustment, and we're going to have one of our people make that adjustment. I understand there may be a loud pop, so please don't get excited.
Mr. Chairman, it took us most of those 12 years to get that working right, so good luck.
Well, we're going to do it in 1 minute, we hope. If not, we expect to have 12 years to work on it, at least.
Thank you very much. Mr. Pilz, we'll now hear from you. We welcome you here. Let me, housekeeping purposes, ask unanimous consent that all of the statements submitted by our witnesses will be made part of the record. And without objection, that'll be the order. Mr. Pilz.
Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Davis, members of the committee, I greatly appreciate the opportunity to present testimony at this hearing. And there is considerable more detail in my written testimony. I endorse all of the conclusions and recommendations in the Joint Union of Concerned Scientists Government Accountability Project report. And to complement that, my testimony will focus on the administration's treatment of the National Assessment of Climate Change Impacts and the problem of the White House Council on Environmental Quality. From April 1995 until March 2005, I worked in the coordination office of what is now called the U.S. Climate Change Science Program, the federal multi-agency federal program that supports the scientific research on climate and associated global environmental change. I had various responsibilities and worked on many projects during those 10 years. I worked directly with the agency leadership and with the senior professional staff in the coordination office. One key ongoing project for which I was responsible involved coordinating the development of and editing 9 editions of the annual report to Congress, Our Changing Planet, which represents the government-wide research program. And in doing that, I would compile and edit into accessible language the contributions of about 90 scientists and science program managers in the federal agencies and labs, and those reports were carefully reviewed and vetted and signed off on by the agency experts, and then they would go to the Executive Office of the President for final editing and review and clearance before publication. During the 2001-2005 timeframe, I came increasingly to the conclusion that the administration was acting to impede forthright communication of the state of climate science and its implications for society, and that the politicization of climate science communication by the current administration was undermining the credibility and integrity of the climate change science program in its relationship to the research community, to the program managers, to policymakers, and to the public. So in March 2005, I left the program office, resigning my position in protest. I saw that the problem was manifested, especially at the points at which scientifically based information regarding climate change was communicated to a wider audience, to Congress, to the public. It wasn't so much a matter of interfering with what scientists were publishing in geophysical research letters or other technical journals. It was when the science would come forward into to be communicated to a wider audience that the political gatekeepers would step in. Now, I'm not a climate scientist by academic training, and I don't debate technical issues. I'll leave that for Dr. Schindel and other eminent climate scientists, but I can tell you what happens when the climate science comes forward into this arena of wider communication and the collision between science and politics. Really among the issues that I regarded as politically significant, particularly significant in this politicization, was the administration's treatment of the National Assessment of Climate Change Impacts, which was carried out in the 1997-2000 timeframe pursuant to the Global Change Research Act of 1990. And this was a report that was developed by a panel of climate and ecosystem scientists and other experts that is to this day the most systematic and comprehensive effort to assess the potential implications of global warming and climate change for the United States. The report identified a range of likely adverse societal and environmental impacts. This report has essentially been made to vanish by the Bush administration. All reference to it by federal agencies has been prohibited. All use of it in reports to Congress and other climate change communications has been suppressed. The scientist stakeholder networks that developed this report have been abandoned, and no follow-on work of a comparable sort has been undertaken. Then there's, I discuss this in considerably greater detail in my written testimony, but starting in 2002, the White House Council on Environmental Quality placed Philip Cooney, the chief of staff, at the table as part of the governance of the U.S. climate change science program. Now, CEQ is a policy shop, not a science office. It's my understanding that Mr. Cooney was the proximate agent of the White House's directive to the federal agencies to suppress the national climate assessment. Of course, he was not acting independently. He was an operative in a chain of command leading up through CEQ Chairman Connaughton to the president. But it was there were many aspects of the way CEQ intervened to manipulate communication on climate change. This was one example. In conclusion, in addition to the UCS GAP recommendations, I would recommend it's very important to revitalize this national assessment process. Every member, I think, has a vital interest in this regional level, sectoral level analysis of putting the top experts together with direct communication with policymakers and other stakeholders to diagnose the problems and develop solutions. And what you need, I think, is this direct, unimpeded communication between the experts and policymakers and get the gatekeepers out of the way.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pilz. Mr. Schindel, Dr. Schindel.
Good morning, and I'd like to thank the committee for
There's a button on the face of the mic.
Is that on? Good morning. I'd like to thank the committee for the opportunity to testify this morning about climate change science and my personal experiences with communication of climate science. As Mr. Chairman noted, I've been a researcher at NASA's Goddard Institute for Space Studies for some time, and I'm a lecturer at Columbia University as well. But today I'm speaking here as an individual. Scientists provide information to policymakers and the public on issues affecting society. Climate change is clearly such an issue, and one for which it is especially critical that decisions be made using the best available scientific information, as the potential cost to society of action or of inaction are large. The Earth as a whole is unquestionably warming, and virtually all climate scientists believe that the evidence regarding a human role in this warming is clear and compelling. Multiple lines of evidence based on measurements, theory, and modeling support these conclusions. The scientific evidence indicates that the Earth is now warmer than at any time during the last 1,000 years. While continued warming is inevitable, the seriousness of the consequences of climate change will depend upon societal action to limit the emissions of greenhouse gases and pollutants that are the dominant cause of global warming. These consequences include droughts and flood, increased severity of summer heat waves, and rises in sea level that could devastate low-lying coastal areas. Although the scientific basis for the conclusion that human activities are altering Earth's climate is extremely strong, their questions are still raised over whether current scientific understanding justifies societal action. One of these arguments has concerned Antarctic temperature trends. While most of the planet has warmed rapidly during the past several decades, much of the Antarctic continent has, by contrast, cooled. Lack of an adequate explanation for this has been cited as evidence that scientific understanding of climate change is simply too incomplete to warrant taking action to mitigate global warming. In the fall of 2004, a team I led at NASA published a paper providing an explanation of how ozone depletion over Antarctica and increasing greenhouse gases could together account for this observed cooling of Antarctica. The study was the first to look at how these two factors work together to influence Antarctic temperatures. It not only helped to explain the observed cooling, but also predicted a warmer future for Antarctica based on projections of continued increases in greenhouse gases. This has clear implications both for the debate on global warming and for potential sea level rise, as Antarctica contains an enormous reservoir of water in its ice sheets. The NASA Press Corps and I wrote a press release on these findings to convey them to the broader public. Well, previous to this time, press releases had been issued rapidly and with reservations from headquarters that basically were made to improve clarity and style. This release was repeatedly delayed, altered, and eventually watered down. When we at GIS inquired of those higher up the NASA chain what was going on, we were told in the fall of 2004 by the press corps that releases were being delayed because two political appointees and the White House were now reviewing all climate-related press releases. Scientists do not simply explore what we are most curious about. We know that our research is funded by the public, and we go to great lengths to provide policy-relevant information to support decision-making. While it was frustrating for me to see my work suppressed, even more importantly, it's a disservice to the public to distort or suppress information needed. But that experience is only one example of a series of actions that attempted to suppress communication of climate science to the public. Also during the fall of 2004, NASA headquarters insisted that a NASA press officer be present to monitor all interviews, either in person or on the phone, a measure most of us felt was unbefitting of a democratic society. As with the interference with press releases, the restrictions were not imposed on other parts of NASA, such as space science, or even other areas of earth science outside of climate research. NASA's new written policy of openness regarding press conferences and releases has been a welcome first step. This clearly defined policy is rather unique among federal scientific agencies and should be emulated at others. As this policy seems to have come about in large part as a response to scrutiny of political interference and communication, I hope that the interest evidenced by this morning's hearing will lead to continued improvements in policies to protect the integrity of government science and its communication to the public. Even with the best possible information, policymakers must make subjective decisions in the face of uncertainty. But these types of decisions go on around us all the time. For example, when a doctor decides on treatment based on the best medical evidence, despite the fact that medical science doesn't know everything there is to know about human physiology. The public must trust the evaluation of the evidence by policymakers in the same way that patients must trust their doctors. Suppression of scientific evidence has undermined the trust between the public and policymakers and between scientists and policymakers. Cases where scientific uncertainties were exaggerated by political appointees have been equally troubling. Restoring the necessary trust will require the highest standards of scientific integrity and transparency in policies regarding scientists' interaction with the public and in decision-making on the urgent issue of climate change. So I thank the committee for holding this hearing.
Thank you very much, Dr. Schindel. Dr. Pilkey.
I thank the chairman, the ranking member, and the committee for the opportunity to offer testimony this morning. My main point today is that politics and science cannot in practice be separated. Consequently, policies for the production, promotion, and use of information in decision making should be based on the realities of science and politics, not on the mistaken impression that they somehow can be kept separate. Efforts to separate them will in most cases only contribute to the pathological politicization of science. Now imagine the following situation. The president has in his administration a range of scientific experts on the most important policy issue of the day. However, the president is denied access to that advice by the manipulative actions of one of his primary advisors, who we'll call the admiral. It turns out that the admiral has the president's ear on matters of science, but he himself, in fact, has no formal scientific training. He justifies his actions on the belief that the United States is engaged in a fundamental religious, political, and economic conflict between good and evil. When two leading government scientists seek to provide advice to the president that differs from that being offered by the admiral asks the FBI to open investigations of these scientists. One of the scientists subsequently faces hearings to consider his lack of loyalty to the United States, and he never again works as a government scientist. The other scientist warns that this case indicates to scientists that, quote, scientific integrity and frankness in advising government on policy matters of a technical nature can lead to later reprisals against those whose earlier opinions have become unpopular, end unquote. One of the nation's leading scientists writes that the relationship between government and scientists has been gravely damaged because the government has given the impression that it would, quote, exclude anyone who does not conform to the judgment of those who in one way or another have acquired authority, end quote. The year 1954, the president, Dwight Eisenhower, the admiral, Louis Strauss, the scientists, Robert Oppenheimer, Hans Bethe, and Vannevar Bush. This vignette, drawn from Benjamin Green's excellent new book, on Eisenhower's science policy, along with the other examples recounted in my written testimony, that discuss issues of science and politics from Richard Nixon through Bill Clinton show that science and politics have always been of concern for policymakers, and the subject of today's hearing indicates that today is no different. There are, however, reasons why today's conflicts are receiving more attention from scholars, political advocates, and politicians. I'll just quickly go through these. There are an increasing number of important issues that are related to science and technology. Policymakers and advocacy groups alike increasingly rely on experts to justify their favorite course of action. Congress, at least for the past 6 years and perhaps longer, has been derelict in its oversight duties, particularly related to issues related to science and technology. Many scientists are increasingly engaging in political advocacy. Some issues of science have become increasingly partisan, as some politicians sense that there is political gain to be found on issues like stem cells, teaching of evolution, and climate change. And lastly, the Bush administration has indeed engaged in hyper-controlling strategies for the management of information. Now, I'll just give a few very short vignettes to illustrate how fundamentally science and politics are interrelated. The language of science in public discussion lends itself to politicization. The New York Times reported last year that NASA scientists at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory had complained because they had been instructed to use the phrase climate change rather than the phrase global warming. A Republican strategy memo did indeed recommend the use of the phrase climate change over global warming, and environmental groups have long had the opposite preference. Another federal scientist at NOAA described how he was instructed by superiors not to use the word Kyoto or climate change. To cite another example, several years ago, the Union of Concerned Scientists, as part of its advocacy campaign on reducing greenhouse gas emissions, recommended the use of the word harbinger to describe current climate events that may become more frequent with future global warming. Subsequently, scientists at NOAA, the National Center for Atmospheric Research, and the Fish and Wildlife Service's Polar Bear Project began to use the phrase in public communication in concert with advocacy groups like Greenpeace. The term has also appeared in official government press releases. Policymakers and their staff are, of course, intimately familiar with these dynamics. We have just recently seen them in practice as Republicans and Democrats have battled over framing President Bush's proposed troop increases in Iraq as a surge or an escalation. An example of how easy it is to misrepresent science in a political setting, consider the memorandum prepared last week by the majority staff of this committee to provide background information on this hearing. The memorandum states quite correctly that a consensus has emerged on the basic science of global warming. It then goes on to assert that, quote, recently published studies have suggested that the impacts of global warming include increases in the intensity of hurricanes and tropical storms, end quote. It supports this claim by citing three papers. But what the memorandum does not relate is that the authors of each of the three cited papers recently participated with about 120 experts from around the world to prepare a consensus statement under the auspices of the World Meteorological Organization, which concluded, quote, no consensus has been reached on this issue, end quote. The WMO statement was subsequently endorsed by the Executive Council of the American Meteorological Society. Thus, the science cited in the committee memo is incomplete and misleading. Such cherry-picking and misrepresentations of science are endemic in political discussions involving science. What has occurred in the preparation of this memorandum is in microcosm the exact sort of thing we have seen with heavy-handed Bush administration information management strategies, which include editing government reports and overbearing management of agency press releases and media contacts with scientists. Inevitably, such ham-handed information management will backfire because people will notice and demand accountability. This oversight hearing today is good evidence for that. My written testimony goes into far more detail on issues of press releases, agency media policies, empanelment of federal advisory committees, and other subjects, which I would be happy to discuss with you further. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. This committee has been trying to get documents from the administration since last July, and we've made requests on a bipartisan basis when Mr. Davis was chairman and I was the ranking member. Now that I'm chairman, he's the ranking member, we're still making those requests. And we have sent today a letter to Mr. James L. Connaughton, chairman of the Council on Environmental Quality, asking again for the information we've requested. And without objection from any member of the committee, I'd like to put the letter by Congressman Davis and myself in the record. Furthermore, the staffs of our committee, Democratic and Republican, were allowed to view these documents that we've requested in camera. They weren't allowed to take them out. And I have a memorandum which provides additional information about the documents from the White House Council on Environmental Quality
being sought by this committee, and I seek to make this memorandum part of the record as well. And without objection, that will be the order. Chair recognizes himself to start off the questions, and I thank all of you for your testimony. Many experts are telling us that global warming is one of the most severe environmental threats facing this nation and the world, that challenges confronting us are enormous, potentially, and therefore I think policymakers have an obligation to understand the science, and we need to get that scientific information without any manipulation of the science, without any suppressing of the reports or misleading the public about the issues, seems to me would be a breach of the public trust. So we have been asking for this information. Dr. Schindel, you're one of the nation's leading climate change scientists, and I want to discuss some of the documents that the committee staff reviewed and ask whether you are concerned about the issues in these documents. First of all, let me begin by asking about some of the edits urged by the White House Office of Management and Budget. OMB asked that an EPA report be rewritten to remove the statement that global warming may, quote, alter regional patterns of climate, end quote, potentially affect the balance of radiation, end quote. Dr. Schindel, do you think this was an appropriate change in the document? The statement in the EPA draft was that climate change can alter regional climates and affect the balance of radiation. Is there any scientific justification for removing these assertions?
No, that is a very well-supported statement. For the changing the energy balance of the planet, we have satellite data that have measured that balance directly for decades now, and we can see it changing. It is extremely well-documented and uncontroversial. Regional patterns, I mentioned before, yes. Antarctica has gone the other way from the rest of the globe. Different areas have warmed more, others less. It's quite clear that this is happening.
Another edit deleted the phrase, quote, changes observed over the last several decades are likely mostly the result of human activities, end quote. And that phrase was replaced with the phrase that said, quote, a causal link between the buildup of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere and the observed climate changes during the 20th century cannot be unequivocally established, end quote. Is this an appropriate change? Does the rephrasing accurately represent the science, or does it mislead the public?
I would say that that is also a misleading statement. While technically true, the first statement that human activities play the dominant role is much more accurate picture of the science.
Some of the edits we reviewed were made by CEQ Chief of Staff Philip Cooney. Now, Mr. Cooney is not a scientist by training. Instead, he's a lawyer who was working as a lobbyist for the American Petroleum Institute before he was appointed to his position at the Council on Environmental Quality. And I'd like to ask you some questions about his edits. In one document, Mr. Cooney deleted a reference to the National Research Council's finding that human activities are causing temperatures to rise. Obviously, the National Research Council is this country's premier scientific body. Can you tell us if there is a scientific basis for deleting a reference to this finding?
No, that is, again, a well-supported statement.
In the same document, Mr. Cooney deleted the phrase, quote, climate change has global consequences for human health and environment, end quote. Is there anything scientifically questionable about this phrase?
Again, no.
And yet another edit, Mr. Cooney wrote that satellite data disputes global warming. Is this scientifically valid?
No. There was for many years a controversy where satellite data showed warming but to a different degree than was seen at the surface or that was predicted by models higher up in the atmosphere. It never disputed global warming. And that controversy has since been resolved.
If climate changes offer us an incredibly serious problem, then we need to get the facts and rely on federal scientists and agencies to give Congress and the public the true facts about this global threat. Yet the preliminary evidence we're seeing from the White House suggests that the administration may have taken a very different approach. If the documents we have seen so far are representative, It appears that the White House installed a former oil industry lobbyist as the chief of staff for the Council on Environmental Quality, and then systematically sought to prevent the Environmental Protection Agency from reporting on dangers to health, the environment, and the economy. In effect, it appears that there may have been an orchestrated effort to mislead the public about the threat of global climate change. These are serious allegations, and they are ones that we'll be exploring in detail in this hearing and in our ongoing investigation. I thank the witnesses very much for answering my questions. I do have further questions, and we'll have a second round for members who wish to pursue a second round. Mr. Davis, I yield to you.
Thank you. Dr. Schindel, let me just say what I would, not asking you can't produce it out, but I'd be very interested in looking at the initial drafts that you had on the press releases and then at the end result. It would give us, I think, a clue in terms of what the administration, I don't have copies of that, but if you could produce that, that would be helpful.
Sorry, I didn't.
The initial drafts of press releases that came out that you said were manipulated and changed over time. I'd be interested in seeing the draft that came from the scientists and the end result that came out. I think that would give the committee a good clue in terms of what transpired in between.
Yes, and there is more detail about that in my submitted written testimony.
I understand that, but if you could produce the doc, I mean, that would be helpful to us as we work forward. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Dr. Pilkey, let me just ask you, in your testimony, you talk about scientists or advocacy groups or even politicians cherry-picking the best facts and using them in a way that's most advantageous to their argument. This has also been called fact-slinging. Why is this approach wrong and harmful to the process?
Well, I think it's inevitable.
Push your button there.
Sorry. I think it's inevitable. I think whenever people make an argument for a particular course of action, they're going to frame their perspective in the best light possible. And when you go out on that limb and you present information selectively, or worse, you misrepresent it, you'll get called on it. It'll damage your own credibility. So I think advocates of all stripes, it's unavoidable to be selective in presentation of information.
Yeah, I guess I'd like to navigate away from that environment. And the reason I've joined Mr. Waxman in the request for documents from the administration, we need to get everything laid out in fact. I think there is some cherry picking going on back and forth. It doesn't help when we can't get them all. It's important to get everything out there so we can get a complete picture and then make an appropriate analysis over what has and hasn't happened. I wonder if you could discuss the policy reasons for executive agencies vetting the work of their employees before public comment is made on behalf of the agency.
Well, is
this a new process or
it's not. For example, the Office of Management and Budget has, at least since the 1920s, gone over witness testimony from government employees. The reason
that's both parties, right?
Of both parties. And the reason for this is that the governance of the United States would be impossible if every government employee were able to go out and interpret the laws, policies, in the way that they saw them. Imagine if officials at the State Department, below the top, every single one of them were going out voicing their views on Iran or the Israeli-Palestine conflict. It would be chaos, complete chaos. So at some level, from the standpoint of policy, government has to coordinate its actions. This becomes difficult when science is involved, because the view is that we can somehow separate science and politics, let scientists only talk about science, let the policy political appointees only talk about the politics. But the reality is science and politics are intermixed. A phrase like dangerous climate change, it relates to the Framework Convention on Climate Change. So if a scientist in their official remarks say that phrase, they're engaging in a political discussion. I should point out NOAA and NASA
they may or may not be right, but that's their opinion, not the opinion of the elected leaders.
Right. I want to point out NOAA and NASA have two different approaches to how scientists communicate with the public. NASA has said that its scientists can take off their agency hat and speak as individuals. NOAA has said in its media policy that they always speak for the agency. This is a perfect topic for congressional oversight. What makes the most sense? Does it make sense to have scientists take off their hat or not? I don't have an answer for that, but we do have inconsistencies across the different agencies.
Yeah. We don't either, and our goal here, I think, is to just get the facts and lay them out, and then the public can judge appropriately where a truth lies. So this age-old process may qualify as politicization, but it also doesn't it can reflect a rational policy by presidential administrations in both parties as well to carry out what they perceive as their mandate.
Yes, let me say, politics is how we get done the business of society. And in popular parlance with the public, politics has kind of a pejorative, negative notion. But I think the government funds about $140 billion worth of scientific research, so it will be relevant to politics.
In one of your writings, you stated that well-regarded scientists who are known believers of global warming is happening also believe that the debate will not be settled for more than a decade. If that's the case, then why is it the only scholars we hear from are the ones who believe it's so glaringly obvious that only a fool or an idiot could question it?
Yeah, the statement you refer to is with respect to the debate over tropical cyclones and climate change. And indeed, I think that's the general consensus is that it's going to take some more research on that topic. On the issue of global warming generally, and particularly global average temperatures, I point you to the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, and Dr. Schindel can probably represent that better than I.
Well, Mr. Connaughton was up here before us, and he admitted that there was climate change or warming going on, that in fact it was man-made, and then I think we need to get to, once we establish those parameters, then we can make intelligent policies in terms of how we deal and what are the ramifications with it. But there was no denial in the administration when they were up here last year as well, and I hope we'll get them back once they produce the documents and they can more fully talk about what their edits are and the like, and we can have a better opportunity to address that. And I look like my time is up.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. Mr. Davis on our side.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank all of the witnesses for appearing. Mr. Pilz, let me ask you, you worked as a senior associate in the Federal Climate Change Science Program. This is the office that coordinates government climate research. You resigned in March of 2005 after 10 years in the office. Can you basically tell us why you resigned?
Yes. I had increasingly come to see that the administration was politicizing the communication of the climate research. It's a $2 billion a year research program involving 12 agencies. And from time to time, this research gets put together in assessments, reports to Congress, and so forth, communicating to a wider audience. And that is the point at which administration political gatekeepers would step in to either ignore the report if they couldn't stop it from being published, misrepresent the intelligence in it if they needed to, or just flat out directly edit it if they could. And I was particularly concerned with this communication function. That's what I was doing. And it became increasingly impossible to work in that environment and to see this going on.
Now, let me ask you. You were there for 10 years.
Yes.
Which means that you were there prior to current Bush administration.
5 years under the previous administration and 5 years under the Bush administration.
So how does this action or activity compare with that of the previous administration?
It's a good question. And let me say, first of all, that no administration is above criticism. But I do think that there was a significant difference. Under the previous administration, the key liaison to the climate change research program was the White House Science Office. Those were scientists, and they their way of thinking and talking and writing about climate change was well within the mainstream of the climate science community, which I think they were trying to feed into the policy process. This was a different situation under the current administration, where you had people who were not scientists, whose concern was not to make the communication clearer and more accurate, but to spin it politically so that the science would not be communicated in such ways to threaten the administration's political position. The administration had made a decision up front that it would not support a regulatory constraint on greenhouse gas emissions, and it seemed to me that they were uncomfortable with any straightforward presentation of the growing body of scientific evidence about global warming.
You also discussed editing in your testimony.
Yes.
And Mr. Philip Cooney was the chief of staff at the White House Council on Environmental Quality. We've established that he was a lawyer and not a scientist. Until 2001, he worked at the American Petroleum Institute as a lobbyist and as their climate team leader. You testified that Mr. Cooney made handwritten edits to several science program reports in 2002 and 2003. Is that correct?
Yes.
Generally, what type of edits were these?
It was a very large number of edits. They came at the 12th hour of the process after all of the career science people had signed off, and it never went back to them. They had the aggregate effect of creating an enhanced, manufactured sense of fundamental scientific uncertainty about global warming, of toning down language about observed warming and impacts, of basically discarding any idea that climate models were useful, and deleting language about the observed or projected impacts of climate change.
It a part of your responsibility to help prepare these documents, similar documents? So you're testifying on the basis of firsthand knowledge, not on the basis of something that you heard, read, or were told about?
No, I had to deal with the edits directly, yes, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I suspect that my time is up.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Issa?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I know it's anecdotal, but how many scientists can raise their hand here on the dais? Just checking. I won't ask how many lawyers are up here. That would be telling. Mr. Peltz, I think I'll start with you. Your degrees and background are political science?
Yes.
So you're not a scientist?
No, I'm not a climate scientist.
So it'd be fair to say you're no more qualified to evaluate these edits than the petroleum lawyer, is that right? I mean, in the greater world of scientists, non-scientists.
I think that climate scientists who look at the edits and would regard them as, in the aggregate, pretty egregious, but I'm not
I appreciate that. I just wanted the simple answer that, you know, we've been trashing a lawyer I've never met. And I'm happy to trash all lawyers, but it comes down to he wasn't a scientist, you're not a scientist. My understanding is Mr. Cooney's edits or proposed edits were then reviewed by a scientific committee convened by the National Research Council, and many of his edits were then disregarded. So I'll be very surprised if my staff is somehow misunderstanding the fact that his edits were not the last word, and in fact there was further scientific review that I'm missing in your testimony. And Mr. Chairman, I hope we can get to the bottom of that, because I'm not sure that that discrepancy can be easily worked out by witnesses. Dr. Griffo, I know you're fairly new to UCS. You've been there about a year, something like that. And you come
a little
out of
longer.
And you come out of Columbia.
Yes.
Columbia.
Yes.
But do you know the history of the organization? I'm trying to understand a little bit more. My understanding is UCS was formed at MIT to oppose the Vietnam War in 1968. Is that roughly correct from
No, sir. That's an incorrect characterization.
Okay. Was it formed in 1968?
Yes, sir.
Was it formed at MIT?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Did it oppose the Vietnam War?
I have no idea, but that was not its purpose in its forming.
Okay, moving down a little bit, you would characterize your group as a pure watchdog organization?
No, sir, we are a science-based nonprofit.
Okay, so you do a study that sends out from a list that you generate, you send out 1,600 questionnaires by email, you get back 19% of them, and then you come up with a whole series of assumptions and you bring them here and say, you know, this is what the science community says. I may not be a scientist. Matter of fact, I'm definitely not a scientist or a lawyer, but I will tell you here today, because I'm very concerned about what's being brought to us as, you know, science. If I take all of the subjective answers to emails, press statements, et cetera, that come into my office anecdotally from my constituents, I would find 100% chance that they want all illegals taken out of the country and no guest worker program, because there is almost 100-0 response, self-selected, Those are the people I hear from, the people who think maybe a guest worker program wouldn't be bad. You've got to really tear it out of them. So I would only say that in the future, if you're going to bring us studies that they live up to, let's say, the standards of John Zogby and not some sort of an email self-serving response. I was very disappointed in seeing that.
Excuse me, may I respond?
Of course.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. Our methodology was, in fact, quite a bit more complex than the way that you have characterized it. We spent an enormous amount of time and energy looking through the climate documents of the Climate Change Research Group, websites. The government does not publish, in fact, a directory of its federal climate scientists. So we did, in fact, have to go through and produce a list. We had very strict criteria for which scientists we included on this list. We had strict criteria for their backgrounds.
Okay,
and
I appreciate that. Can you make that available to us?
Absolutely.
And is there peer review or scientific oversight of your selection? And was there an offset to say that your selection was valid or invalid? In other words, Mr. Pilkey was... Would he, in fact, have had a chance to say, oh, this is a bad list, you missed 300, 400? Was there any kind of an independent review?
Yes, sir.
And by whom?
By a number of climate scientists across the community. And, in fact, Mr. Pilts was one, and there were several others.
List. Mr. Pilts is a political scientist.
But he is aware of who are the federal climate scientists doing that kind of research, and he was one of many individuals.
I appreciate
that
it. I'm afraid I don't think that you know you've made your case.
I'm not quite
Dr.
done, sir.
Dr. Pilkey, you said in your statement, and I think it's very notable that there's going to be politics in all of this. Let me just, Mr. Chairman, if my time.
Go ahead and finish
okay.
your question.
Let me just ask one simple question. During the Eisenhower period, you mentioned. Isn't it true that while the President Eisenhower was leading the war against the Soviets, he was in fact downplaying the risk and the threat while funding the very things that allowed us to win the Cold War? Isn't that essentially the story of Eisenhower's managing of things like that threat?
I think essentially in a soundbite fashion that's accurate, but the story of Eisenhower and particularly the nuclear test ban efforts, this was before my time, it's on academic literature, is that there was tremendous conflict among competing scientists, all very preeminent, but the politics of whether we wanted to engage in nuclear tests in the atmosphere or not illustrate how science came to become very politicized even 50 years ago.
Thank you, Mr.
Chairman.
Ms. Watson?
I want to thank all the witnesses that are here today for being direct and answering the questions directly. There is no attempt to intimidate. We're trying to get information. So my questions go to Dr. Riffo. Making available the study results lead me to raise these questions. What percentage of the scientists personally felt pressured to eliminate the words climate change, global warming, or similar terms for their scientific communications? And I have been told, as a member of Congress, do not use the word global warming. Well, they're telling me. They don't know who I am. And so can you answer that, please?
Yes, thank you very much. 46% perceived or personally experienced pressure to eliminate those words. And I would say that is a total of 147 climate scientists. So that number should be zero.
Okay, so that is, those are government scientists who felt pressured to avoid even using the words climate change or global warming. That's
yes.
The number?
Yes.
Because I know what I was told. Okay, thank you. And did any scientists see their work or the work of others changed or edited during reviews in ways that changed the meaning of their scientific findings? And you might have referred to that. I happened to be in the back. I had a conference. And so could you respond?
Yes, thank you. 43%, which was over 2 in 5 of our respondents, and I would also say that is 128 federal climate scientists
who personally experienced or perceived changes or edits during review that changed the meaning of their findings.
And were their scientific findings ever misrepresented by agency officials?
Yes, in fact, 37% of our respondents, which is 110 federal climate scientists, perceived or personally experienced agency misrepresentation of their findings.
And how many total instances of political interference did government climate scientists report?
That was at least 435. We had a range in each of the questions that they could answer, so that is the smallest number. It may indeed be much higher.
And how many government scientists personally experienced political interference?
Personally experienced, I will have to get you that number. I don't have it in front of me, but it is a large percentage.
Okay. And now let me ask Mr.
150. Thank you.
150? Okay, thank you. Mr. Blitz and Mr. Schindel, Dr. Schindel, excuse me. And do these numbers surprise you first, Mr. Blitz?
They surprised me a little bit that it's quite so high. I was aware of particular case studies, but this shows me that this is a much more pervasive pattern throughout the agencies than even I was aware of before.
And Dr. Schindel?
Yes, I had been aware of this mostly amongst the most prominent, the lab directors at the various research institutes. So this indicates that it was more widespread than I expected as well.
I am wondering, Dr. Griffo, if we could actually get some of the scientific reports that have been changed. The wording has been changed. Can we get those? I think there was a request from the minority ranking member, and if we could get that, it would certainly help. I think this kind of thing must stop. I have witnessed the administration politicizing factual information and misleading the Americans. I will not be misled, and I like the facts in front of me. The interpretation of the facts is what we need to hear and see, because I think many of us are being misled. We cannot stand for it, and I want to thank you very much, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Watson. Mr. Selling?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Schindel, every office that's represented by the membership on the dais up here has a vetting process for every statement that goes out of our offices. And of course, everyone would agree that that tends to be political in nature, and we want to make sure that the political discussion ends up with one voice that represents the top of the heap, if you will. I don't suppose that there's anybody on this dais that would think that that is problematic. However, when we talk about this issue and the matters that go on in this hearing, we are going to be issuing similar statements. And do you have any guidance for this committee about how we might make that transition from science to politics to get the truth out to the people, recognizing that there will be dramatically different statements coming out of the various offices?
Well, I think that the scientific community has managed to convey the general viewpoint or the mainstream viewpoint quite well in numerous venues already. And that's taken place when the president called for the National Academy to look at climate change after the last IPCC assessment report. And later this week, the next IPCC assessment report will be issued. And I think these are really authoritative reports that It's really, in many ways, it's a wonderful thing. It's if you had a problem and you were able not just to get the advice of one or two people, but to get the best experts in that particular area from all over the world to look at the evidence and really present what their best evaluation is, I think you'd be very pleased.
And so
I think
would it be correct to say that opinions coming out of the scientific community are uniform then with regard to climate change or global warming?
Our
with regard to climate change, global warming, whatever you want to call it. Is it your contention then that the opinions within the scientific community are unanimous?
Well, that would certainly depend on the particular detail of which issue is being discussed. But in general, there's never unanimity in science. It's a back and forth of ideas. Scientists are by nature skeptical, always doubting what everybody else is saying. And a consensus emerges over time.
So then is it your further contention that somehow minority opinions aren't worthwhile in discussion, that we ought to just disregard those?
I don't think that anybody's views are disregarded as long as they go through the standard scientific process, which is peer review. So papers and documentation or claims of scientific nature must be validated, and they must be supported, and that support has to be evaluated by scientists. And claims are submitted every once in a while. There are papers that come into the same journals that mainstream climate scientists publish in, and those are evaluated by scientists, and the problem is that these claims don't pass muster. They don't have the scientific evidence to back them up, so they're not making it into the debate because they're not judged to have adequate support. So those that do get published are included in reports like the IPCC, the National Assessment, the Academy reports. Anything that gets through the process is completely valid.
Okay, so I want to make sure I'm getting this note. Are you saying that there's no disagreement among the scientific community regarding global warming or climate change, yes or no?
There's no restraint?
That there's no disagreement?
No, I'm not saying that there's no disagreement. I'm saying that what...
Well, then are you saying that those in the minority view ought to be disregarded out of hand?
I do not think that anybody's viewpoint needs to be disregarded, but I would say that when the vast majority of the community comes down on one side and there are remarkably few voices on the other side that are able to adequately back up the claims that they make, then I think the conclusion is pretty clear of where our best judgment of what's going on lies.
So correct me if I'm wrong, then you're saying that the real scientists all agree about global warming and climate change.
No, I wouldn't disparage any scientists' claims based on their background or what they believe. Somebody mentioned Richard Lindzen from MIT earlier. He is an eminent scientist, has done great work in the past. He is free to publish anything he likes as long as it gets through the same process that everybody else uses. And that process is the best way we've had for centuries now to really give science the rigorous evaluation it needs to determine which theories win out and which evidence is strong enough that we believe it's most likely to be true. And that has come down on the side of mainstream scientists.
Thank you, Mr. Sully. Your time has expired, and I want to call on Mr. Tierney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Schindel, I'm impressed that you've taken the time personally to come here today. And I want to clarify, you're here, I understand, on your own as a scientist, am I correct? You have no political agenda, or do you?
That's correct.
That you're here as a scientist?
Yes, I'm here to testify about climate science, and I can relate my personal experiences. That's
Thank
all.
You. Mr. Pilz, when Mr. Issa was questioning, there was some inference, I thought, that Mr. Clooney made edits, and I think he was implying or at least asking whether or not there was another round of production on that, but we have documents that indicate one note directly from Mr. Clooney was saying that these changes must be made. And then we have the EPA memorandum itself where the staff gives just three options to the administrator to choose. One is that you accept everything CEQ and OMB submits. Second option was you remove the climate section altogether. And the third was that you go back and forth and try to reach some compromise, which they decided would antagonize the White House and likely wouldn't be feasible to negotiate an agreeable text. So they opted for just taking the climate change out of the report. Do you have a different recollection of that? Was there, in fact, any additional back and forth after Mr. Clooney made his edits?
I wasn't involved in that EPA report, but analogously from my own experience with climate change science program reports, the reports would be drafted and reviewed and vetted and approved by a large number and layers of career science people and federal science program managers. That's what I worked on. All of my stuff had to be approved before it could go forward. The White House would come in after that process and intervene, and it would never have to go back for clearance with the scientists. As for the Academy of Sciences reviewed the program strategic plan and in general praised it, but criticized it for the vanishing of the National Assessment of Climate Change Impacts. We criticized it over and over again as a conspicuous and unwarranted omission, and the administration has stonewalled the Academy of Sciences since the day the Academy said that and has offered no defense, no response in its own defense.
Thank you. You know, we've obtained, the committee has obtained some documents, surprisingly enough. We've obtained email correspondence between NOAA and the White House employees, and they indicate quite an involvement of the White House with the press contacts of NOAA scientists. I think they show a kind of political interference that we're talking about here today, and it's not really the results of a couple of low-level or overzealous press officials, but direct involvement by the White House. And I want to go through just a couple of these emails, if I could, and then ask some of the panelists about it. They're all these emails are from June of 2005. The first email is from an environmental reporter. The reporter requests an interview with a NOAA scientist about how climate change science has become politicized. The second email, the scientist responds that the reporter will need to ask the NOAA press coordinator. In the third email, the NOAA press officer writes to the White House Council on Environmental Quality and says the press officer expressed concern that the reporter may fish for the answers she's looking for, but notes that the NOAA scientist, quote, knows his boundaries. Then the press officer asks for the White House instructions by the end of the day. And the next email from the NOAA press officer states, if we have CEQ approval to go ahead, then that would be good. In another email, the NOAA press officer reports that CEQ and the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy have given the green light for the interview. The press officer then states that CEQ officials want me to monitor the call and report back when done. So my question, you know, Mr. Pilz and Mr. Schindel, are you surprised that the NOAA press officers were reporting back to the White House about the content of press interviews with government climate scientists? And do you think it's appropriate for the White House to decide whether or not a government scientist can speak to the press?
I'm not surprised. I do not think it's appropriate. I don't think that when the press makes an inquiry to the Federal Climate Change Science Program, that everything should have to be routed to the NOAA press office, which has been politically compromised by the administration officials who are at the head of NOAA. We need a different, more unimpeded type of communication out of the climate change science program.
Dr. Schindel, your comments?
Well, I'm not terribly surprised either, because it sounds very similar to what we were told at NASA was happening when we were inquiring as to why we were having so much difficulty communicating, that this was coming from the White House. So it sounds very similar, and I don't think it's appropriate.
Dr. Pilkey made a comment that the Office of Management Budget looks at witness testimony for administration policy consistency, and it seemed to say that that was the reason why all this was okay. Am I wrong in thinking there's got to be some distinction between a policy and somebody's comments on science, or the fact, their conclusions based on fact? Dr. Griffo, you?
Well, let me correct an impression, if I gave it, that it was okay. It's not okay.
Dr. Griffo's a ventriloquist. I'm sorry, Mr. Pilkey. Go ahead, you can answer it, but I had asked Dr. Griffo the question. You want to answer it? You want to go ahead?
I'm sorry, I thought you were talking to me.
No, but I'll give you the chance if you want to have something to say on that.
No, go ahead.
Okay, thank you.
My apologies.
Dr. Griffo.
Thank you. I think that when you get that PhD, when you become a scientist, you do not give up your, I mean, I think that, I know that. You don't give up your constitutional rights. You maintain your right as a citizen of free speech, and I think that's incredibly important, that we remember that this is discussions about science. And I would like to say that the results that we found, our experience with this issue, is really a small part of what Mr. Pilkey is talking about. He's talking about a very interesting topic, which is the role of science in public policy. Fascinating. But that is not what our program is really focusing on. We are looking at the science that is changed, that is manipulated, that is somehow touched and in a way that alters it before it even gets into that public policy arena. And what we are calling for is that scientists are allowed to speak about their scientific results and get that information out to the taxpayers that are paying for it, to the community at large, to policymakers, to everyone that needs to really understand this issue.
Is it a fair statement? Sorry?
Your time has expired.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Lynch?
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Earlier in this hearing, there was the suggestion of bias on the part of the Union of Concerned Scientists because of a position that the organization may or may not have taken in 1968 on the Vietnam War. I hope I'm not the only one in this hearing to point out the elephant in this room, and perhaps it's just me, but we have a situation here where the Bush administration chose as its chief of staff for the White House Council on Environmental Quality a person who had led the oil industry's fight against limits on emissions of greenhouse gases. This is someone who worked for the American Petroleum Institute. So I scratched my head to say, why would the administration put someone who was so vehemently biased in an important role like this? And Mr. Pills, you know, the analogy of the fox and the hen house is not appropriate, I believe, in this case. Mr. Pills, in your responsibility in your official capacity prior to resigning in protest, you were responsible for editing a document called Our Changing Planet. Is that correct?
Yes, the annual report to Congress.
Right. And just to clear something up, your role there was to take information from 90 scientists, the reports of those scientists, contributions made by them, and put it in a form that is usable by Congress.
That's right, and to then fact-check it with them before it went forward.
So these weren't your own opinions. These
No.
were the opinions of this were bona fide scientists with obviously scientific research to back up their opinions.
Yes.
Okay. Now, what I'd like to do is get on the record. You've talked generally about what was done by Mr. Cooney, and it's my understanding that after he resigned, he went back to work for ExxonMobil. That's the information that I have from majority staff. But I'd like to talk about some specific instances of his editing and what that might have reflected. Can you give us a few specific examples of edits by Mr. Cooney to this report to Congress?
Yes, I can do that. If I may just preface that for a moment by saying I really have tried to emphasize what seems to me the illegitimacy of the whole process by which this happened, rather than arguing particular edits. And in many cases, these hundreds of edits would just change a word or two. But you know what happens when you change shall to may.
Right.
But there are other places where whole chunks of text are deleted. And for example, there's one passage where it came to him saying warming will also cause reductions in mountain glaciers and advance the timing of the melt of mountain snowpacks in polar regions. In turn, runoff rates will change, flood potential will be altered in ways that are currently not well understood. There'll be significant shifts in the seasonality of runoff that will have serious impacts on native populations that rely on fishing and hunting for their livelihood. These changes will be further complicated by shifts in precipitation regimes and a possible intensification and increased frequency of extreme hydrological events. That was deleted.
Now, did Mr. Cooney ever give a plausible reason why he would extract a warning of snow melt and degradation of glaciers, which we're seeing now? Did he ever give a plausible reason why he would remove that warning to Congress?
He called it speculative musing.
Speculative musings.
Speculative musing.
Okay. Are there other documents or other instances that you can point to that would help us?
There was in another passage the draft said, with continued perturbation of the Earth's radiative balance, climate model projections based on a range of possible scenarios, such as a doubling of atmospheric carbon dioxide, suggest that during the 21st century, climate changes due to human influences will be substantially larger than what has been identified up until now.
Okay, and again, if I could just pause there.
He said delete.
It sounds like you're saying that the amount of carbon and that measurement is very important. What was his response to that assumption, or projection?
The models don't all give the same result, so it's inappropriate to speak in summary terms about this type of outcome.
Okay. Mr. Chairman,
thank you very much.
I could go on, but that's that sort of thing.
Thank you, Mr. Lynch. Mr. Higgins?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Pilts, I'd like to ask you about the national assessment on potential consequences of climate variability and change. Your office was involved in putting this document together in 2001. You have described it, and I quote, as the most comprehensive and authoritative scientifically based assessment of the potential consequences of climate change in the United States, end of quote. In it, there's projections of temperature increases and the consequences those increases would have on our natural environment. This is obviously an important report. Why haven't we heard more about it?
Well, it was distributed to every member of Congress around the end of 2001, but very early on, 2001, about the same time that the administration was pulling back from the Kyoto Protocol talks, we were directed by the White House Science Office to start deleting all references to the national assessment, in the first instance to the annual report to Congress, and then in the later in the strategic plan for the climate change science program. There were lawsuits filed attempting to suppress the national assessment and even remove links to it from a government website, although it was a taxpayer-funded study filed by the Competitive Enterprise Institute, which is an ExxonMobil-funded policy group. The lawsuits were dismissed, in one case with prejudice, but the administration awarded the political victory to the litigants by back channel, without much of a paper trail, instructing the federal agencies just to stop using this report and going forward with any analogous activities. And I think it's because this process of putting scientists in direct communication with policymakers and stakeholders, region by region, sector by sector, generated a type of dialogue that probably was going to lead to greater public pressure for taking the global warming problem seriously and doing something about it. And this was a type of discourse that the administration just did not want to see happening, in my judgment.
So in this instance and others that you have been referenced in your testimony, this is not isolated, this is systemic.
That's right, but I think that I regard this as the central climate science scandal of the Bush administration, because it so pervasively shut down a widespread process of intelligence gathering and national preparedness, and we now have 6 years without high-level support for this type of process for linking science to society, and we're losing something because of that.
Do you have any evidence that policy, that attitude has changed?
No.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Higgins. Mr. Shays?
Thank you, Ms. Pilts. I want to state from the start, I believe that there is a global climate change. I believe I would call it global warming. I don't get too exercised which term I use. I think it's man-made, and I think it stared us in the face for years. So I disagree with the position and policy of this administration. But I find myself being a little defensive about whether we are talking about changes in scientific reports or disagreements over policy. And I came here thinking I would be more inclined to say change in scientific reports. And as I listen, I find myself, I don't know if I'm feeling defensive here for the administration or just really saying, let's be fair. The bottom line is you're not a scientist, correct?
That's right. I'm not a climate scientist.
You're not a scientist.
Right.
climate scientist or anything. You're not a scientist, correct?
No, I try to communicate with and represent the
scientists.
So
why did you even say you're not a climate scientist? That gives the impression you're a scientist.
He's a political scientist.
So,
I'm a social scientist by academic training, yes.
I find myself being defensive because I feel like you're trying to give an impression that's a little false to me. There are 90 reports, 80 reports, whatever. You took these reports and you, in synthesizing, that's your term, it's editing. You take some of what they did and leave something out, correct?
Well, yes, to try to clarify the communication,
no,
yes.
No, you don't need to clarify,
yes.
Because the bottom line is you want to use the word synthesize because that is a more comfortable word for you to use than edit. The bottom line is you edited. You, as a non-scientist, took scientific reports and you edited them down to a position that you felt was respectful of what they did.
Yes.
And I understand that. But you're not a scientist and you edited. And the bottom line is you have come to a conclusion that when another non-scientist took this, he chose to say, well, which report, which scientist you're listening to and which aren't. And somebody who also wasn't a scientist said, we don't want you to make this comment and this description. I think they were wrong. I think that they made a policy decision that ultimately may even be destructive. So I'm not even going to argue about that. I just don't like the fact that we are basically trying to give the impression that somehow you are a scientist and you came in and you described it all and then this non-scientist disagreed with you. That's the feeling that I came before this hearing. And I respect you for your convictions. I respect you for even resigning if you think you weren't being treated fairly or positions were being distorted. But I still come down to the points I've just made. Now, what would you like to tell me?
Well, first of all, I worked with, collaborated with the scientists and had their sign off. I was not at war with the mainstream science community. That's one. I did not write or edit the National Climate Assessment. If you look at the panel of eminent people who wrote it, it's a very impressive group of people. It's not junk science. It's stuff that should not be suppressed.
I understand that.
Okay. I don't know. Nobody was telling the scientists what they could publish in the technical journals. This was about communication, but it wasn't just policy. It was spinning the scientific, the state of knowledge statements
right.
about science for political
effect.
Let me ask
you, were there any scientific reports that you chose to not discuss because they were in conflict with a majority of the position? Was there any scientific...
Normally I worked...
Let me ask the question, be very clear. Was there any scientific data that you looked at that you did not include because it wasn't with the mainstream?
I don't think so. I worked with what was passed forward to me by the career science people.
So, well, that's important. And you're saying that all the scientific data that was provided you, you included and didn't leave any out.
Generally speaking, there was editing for length. But if you look at the reports that I worked on, it's generally speaking non-controversial material. It's pretty straightforward.
Right.
Descriptions of research highlights and program plans and so forth.
Well, my time is coming to an end, but just I want to be clear on this one thing. Were you selective in the scientific comments that you provided? Did you make any decision to include this scientific data and not this scientific data? That's really what I'm asking.
Yeah, I engaged in some editorial selection. As I say, but everything I did was in collaboration with the scientists, was reviewed, revised, vetted, and approved by the career science people before it could go forward.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shays. Ms. McCollum.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, I was really surprised just how widespread this problem was. Last week, my office had an opportunity to speak with a climate scientist who's now working in Minnesota, formerly employed by the federal agency, and she saw the suppression of climate change research firsthand. In her words, and I quote her, "We were told the answers to our analysis before we conducted our research. End of quote. I remember from my science classes going through scientific discovery that you set up a hypothesis and then you proved it right or wrong, not the other way. Mr. Schindel, can I ask you for some help? The committee staff reviewed some CEQ offices. They looked at some documentation, and one of the documents that CEQ Chief of Staff Phil Cooney informs Kevin O'Donovan who's in the executive office of the president, that they will start to use a recent paper by Willie Soon and Sally Balanis to rebut the views of the National Academy of Sciences and Intergovernment Panel on Climate Change. Now, apparently, this Schooner-Ballas paper asserts that the 20th century is probably not the warmest climate period of the last millennium. Are you familiar with this paper? I might be saying the one person's name wrong, too. You might want to correct that for the record.
Yes, I am familiar with that.
Now, I served on the Education Committee, and one of the things that the president and the administration was very focused on was that teachers would teach to the subject that they were trained in. Can you tell us about this paper? My understanding is that it should, using this paper to rebut the National Academy and the IPC, is maybe these weren't the best scientists to do that?
This was an interesting paper, and I think it demonstrates the point that came up in one of the other members questioning about what's allowed. Really, whatever stands up to scientific scrutiny is allowed, and it's not dependent on the views of the scientists. So Soon and Balanis are both astronomers. They are not climate scientists, but that's okay, as long as their work stands up. And basically what that paper was is no original research. It is instead a survey of other climate scientists' work, where they basically took all of the uncertainties and caveats, things that were not included in the studies, compiled them, and said that then, given that there were so many uncertainties and things that were not fully understood, we could not say much of anything about climate change. However, that is in complete contrast to the views of nearly every expert in climate science. So I think that is not at all representative. And I would not say that one alternative paper undermines the thousands of papers that go into a document like the IPCC report.
So they're scientists, they're entitled to their own opinion, but this is not their field of expertise, climate change.
That's correct.
It's my understanding that the paper led to a lot of controversy. Press reports indicated that the study was funded by the oil industry, and that the editor-in-chief of the journal resigned when the owners of the journal refused to allow him to publish an editorial saying that the paper, in fact, was flawed. Is that your understanding?
Yes, I believe that is correct.
One of the more troubling aspects of this document seems to be that it reflects on what amount of strategy decision that the White House had in part. In fact, that the White House was going to use this study to rebut the prevailing scientific reviews. Do you find this troubling to you as a scientist to have a person who's a scientist but in a totally different field, not an expert in what you're working on, be given the same weight and credibility in rebutting what you're saying rather than a peer in the same field of science?
I do find that quite troubling, and I use the analogy in my testimony of a patient having to trust their doctor, and this would be kind of tantamount to you having a heart condition and getting reports from heart experts all over the world giving you their best opinion of all the medical data, and then somebody coming down and say, why don't you look at what these skin doctors had to say? There are a couple people, you know, I think let's throw out this assessment by all the world's heart experts and let's take this one instead. I think it would be very foolish for anybody to do such a thing.
Well, I thank you for that. I'm very concerned, and in looking on page 21 of the document, atmospheric pressure. On page 21, I have perceived in others or personally experienced changes and edits during the review that changed the meaning, that changed the meaning of scientific findings. Further in on the page it says, statements by officials at my agency that misrepresented a scientist's finding. You know, I can look at the color of your blue tie, sir, I can say it's robin's egg blue, I can say it's baby blue, but a scientist could look at that tie and tell me exactly what color it is by science, and that's not indisputable. The other two items are my opinion, but the other one is science. So I thank you so much, Mr. Schindel. What would you say?
Well, the gentlelady's time has expired.
I would just say that is an interesting counterpoint to some of the cases that were raised before where there are synthesis documents. The cases where there were interference at my agency were specific scientific reports. There's no policy involved. There's simply, this is the result of a particular set of observations or a particular modeling study. And those were nevertheless edited when they showed the dangers of climate change.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Mr. Sarbanes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have just a couple of questions that are interrelated. The first is, and this may sound a little naive, but what I'm trying to get to is your understanding, and Mr. Piltz, I think you're probably in the best position to address this, but your understanding of what was motivating people inside the CEQ, inside the White House. And I guess the range of options could include that you had a small handful of people that had sort of been given license within this office to exercise their own personal, ideological, and political perspective, and that's what they were doing. They were responding, and this would be more sinister, to pressure from external influences, and/or that they were carrying out a fairly specific and focused policy agenda coming even from higher levels. So, based on your observation of this conduct, that was occurring in the CEQ. Can you speak to that at all?
Well, I wasn't in the room with them while that was being worked out, so I have to analyze it from a step back. But as a political scientist, I would say that there are elements of all three of those to explain this. I think the administration came in with a predetermined political agenda on greenhouse gas emissions and the global warming problem that was not going to support a regulatory policy, the willingness to allow political operatives to engage in misrepresenting the intelligence on the science side, the spinning of the politics back into the science communication is a problem. I think they were representing particular stakeholder interests, particular in conjunction with political allies. It also seemed to me that they brought with them some kind of animus toward proactive government problem solving and preparedness to deal with consequences of decisions or not making decisions and have left us in this position. So somehow this the way the global warming issue has been handled is somehow indicative to me of a modus operandi that we've seen across a range of issues, and this is the global warming piece of it.
Right.
Does that make any sense?
No, it does. I think you're saying it's sort of symptomatic of an attitude that has cut across other ways that the administration has handled things. Let me ask you this. I'm trying to understand the purpose of a retrospective like this, I think, is to inform kind of what goes forward. And I'm struggling to understand for myself the point at which one can say that the scientific inquiry for the moment is concluded. I understand this is ongoing and it changes every day. But where you feel comfortable as a scientific community coming forward and saying, this is what we know, and it's sort of reached the point where sort of the political aspect of it ought to be kept at bay, because people will say, well, you know, we're just trying to bring more balance, we're just trying to complete the picture. So is it at the point where the National Academy of Sciences, for example, says, you know, there is a strong, almost unprecedented consensus on this issue, that one can feel comfortable that this represents good science, and we ought to accept it as such? So where is that line?
You can't try to make the science community say that they're absolutely certain about something. When they say something's very likely, you ought to take it seriously. The science community has a lot of integrity and be owning up to their own uncertainties, and they're always asking the next question. But you always make your policy decisions in the face of some uncertainty about the implications. What happens is people with political agendas come in who have a predatory relationship to that uncertainty language, and they use it in a way that is different from the way the scientific community uses it. You will not get them to say we're 100% certain. And I'm always cringe when somebody says, the science is in, it's time for action. I mean, we have a national research program that is our basic intelligence capability for understanding what we're doing to planet Earth. That needs to be supported. It's always had strong bipartisan support, regardless of political debates about the policy implications. And that scientific research needs to go on. But while it's addressing whatever questions need to be addressed, policymaking has to proceed in tandem with that, not at the end of some science process. The two have an ongoing interplay.
That's a powerful phrase, predatory relationship to the uncertainty of the science, and I'll use that if you give me permission. My time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Sarbanes. Mr. Welch.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Pelkey, I noticed in your written testimony you made a claim that the memo that was prepared by the committee staff for this hearing is, quote, exactly the same sort of thing that we have seen with the heavy-handed Bush administration information strategies. And I take the charge that you make very seriously. You are, if I understand it, essentially accusing the committee of the conduct that it's investigating. You took specific offense with the memo's discussion of the state of science regarding the connections between global warming and hurricanes, where the memo notes, recently published studies have suggested that the impacts of global warming include increases in the intensity of hurricanes in tropical storms. So, taking this seriously, we asked the committee staff to contact these leading researchers to follow up to see if there was anything we should be concerned with in that memo. And Dr. Judith Curry, as you know, a leading researcher, told us that all the research scientists working in the area of hurricanes agree that average hurricane intensity will increase with increasing tropical sea surface temperature. Theory, models, observations all support this increase. And she tells us that the recent research indicates an impact of global warming is more intense hurricanes. The current debate and lack of consensus is about the magnitude, she says, of the increased intensity, not its existence. And Dr. Michael Mann, also a prominent researcher, tells us that in his view, you've misinterpreted the WMO report in arguing that it somehow contradicts information provided in the scientific background of the hearing memo that you had a chance to review. And he says the current state of play with the science on this is accurately summarized in the hearing memo. Now, given all the testimony that we've received today, I am wondering whether you stand by your statement, which is essentially a challenge to the memo of this committee. And we've heard evidence of hundreds of incidents of political interference. We've heard very direct testimony from some of the people here and others that the White House did edit documents to introduce doubt where essentially no doubt existed. and we've heard scientist contacts with the press were in fact being monitored by the White House. So in light of today's testimony and the information provided to the committee by Drs. Curry and Mann, is it still your belief that the committee's hearing memo is, to quote you, exactly the same sort of thing the Bush administration has done?
Yeah, and I thank you for the opportunity to clarify. And I did say the word in microcosm. This is, I think, and I will stand by exactly what I said, and I'm happy to talk about the science and impacts of hurricanes as long as you would like, because it's an area I've been researching for about 15 years. The memo includes the statement, recently published studies have suggested that the impacts of global warming include increases, and it cites three papers that look retrospectively, back in time. So it's not talking about projections in the future. So the statement by Dr. Judy Curry, who's a great scientist who I have a lot of respect for, isn't on point here. And I want to make a point that I hope everyone recognizes. The same dynamic that we just saw talking about the Soon and Balayunas paper as the one outlier contradicting the consensus, we see this on the exact other side. Now, there was 120 scientists that include Carrie Emanuel and Greg Holland, who were co-authors of those three papers cited here, came up with a consensus statement on hurricanes and climate change. That's analogous to the IPCC. Subsequently, the American Meteorological Society has endorsed that statement. Now, I'm not a climate scientist, and just like I accept the consensus of the IPCC, I'm compelled to accept the consensus of the hurricane community. Now, it's very easy to pick out a Soon and Balayunas paper or selectively email a scientist and say, what is your view? And I respect that Dr. Mann and Dr. Curry have their views about what the statement says, but I am absolutely 100% certain that the statement that's in your background memo does not faithfully represent the science. It selects among the science present a perspective. And that is inevitable, and we have to recognize that, and no one is immune from it. It does not excuse the Bush administration from their actions, of course. But let's not pretend that somehow we can separate out scientific truth from political preferences. The reality is they're always going to be intermixed.
The memo, the committee memo, states very specifically that the evidence suggests that link.
Yes, and that's true.
The evidence is there.
Yes, it is there.
And you are now taking the leap to suggest that the committee memo is similar to the conduct of interfering with scientific debate
in microcosm,
that we've heard testimony about from these scientists.
In microcosm, it shows how easy and simple it is to selectively report scientific information to favor a particular agenda. Absolutely. The statement in there is accurate. It's just like what we heard about some of the changes. The statement that Mr. Cooney made, some of them were judged to be accurate but misleading. This is exactly the same sort of thing.
Thank you very much. I wonder if Dr. Griffo, if you could respond, if you have any different point of view than Dr. Pilkey.
I would just respond by saying that, you know, peer review is the gold standard, and that this is something that, you know, science will resolve. I mean, ultimately, you know, as the scientific process continues to study hurricane intensity and what that means and what it doesn't mean, you know, we still have all these other lines of evidence that really point us in the direction that we have all been talking about here today, which is that this is a huge and serious problem and we need to get on it.
Mr. Wells, will you yield to me?
I yield to the chairman, yes, thank you.
Doctor, you're a doctor, but you're not a scientist. You're a political scientist.
No, I'm a political scientist. That's
and you said you're absolutely certain that you're right on this issue and that Dr. Curry and Dr. Mann are wrong in their statement. Isn't that quite a statement for you to make? No scientist here has been willing to make any statement that there's absolute certainty, because the process of science continues to evaluate things. Dr. Schindel, you're familiar with Dr. Curry and Dr. Mann. Is that correct? Dr. Schindel, are you familiar with those two?
Yes.
Are they somewhat isolated in the field with their own theories at odds with the majority of scientists?
No, they are quite within the mainstream.
In fact, isn't Dr. Mann one of the leading scientists in global warming issues?
Yes, he is.
And Dr. Curry as well?
Yes.
So I'm just wondering whether we should believe them or the certainty of Dr. Pilkey that they're wrong.
May I clarify, Mr.
Yes,
Waxman?
Yes, please.
Yeah, my certainty is as to what the WMO hurricane consensus says. And let me say, I have led two interdisciplinary papers, including climate scientists, peer-reviewed, reviewing the science of hurricanes and climate change. They were published in the Bulletin of the American Meteorological Society in 2005 and 2006. And the summary that is in those papers has stood up to the WMO and AMS consensus points. So it's fair to say your background means that you can't speak on this topic and so on, but do recognize that scholars today work on interdisciplinary teams, and there is literature that Dr. Schindel would accept as being in the mainstream peer review.
I don't dispute your ability to study the field and make comments on it, except when we say that evidence suggests something, which seems to be backed by Dr. Mann and Dr. Curry, for you to say they're wrong. We didn't reach the conclusion. We said evidence suggests this.
Let me clarify again. I did not say that they're wrong. I said that their views are not consistent with the mainstream consensus in the community. I am 100% sure of that statement.
Do you know whether that's true, Dr. Schindel, or not?
I believe that their views are consistent with the mainstream consensus, and I think that we're having a slight semantic argument over what the mainstream consensus is. Is it they've increased, hurricanes have increased in severity in the past, will they increase in the future? And I think that they're, you know, it's an interesting issue, this one, because unlike some of the other aspects of global warming that are better understood, there is some legitimate controversy, and so it can lead to these kind of discussions. But one of the interesting things about uncertainty, there's two points. One is that scientists are very open about the uncertainty, and that's what leads to these kind of statements saying, yes, we don't know everything about it. Another is that while we've been looking at model projections to inform us about the kind of world we're likely to live in, when you look at the studies of hurricanes, they're suggesting that maybe the models are really drastically under-predicting what's likely to happen. And these studies that are referred to in your statement from this committee are showing much, much stronger increases than anybody's model guess. So yes, there is uncertainty, but that cuts both ways. It might mean we don't understand everything, and so it could be better. It might also mean that things might end up far worse than what we're saying they're likely to be.
Thank you. Mr. Welch, do you want to conclude?
I'll just finish by going back to Dr. Pelkey. What I understand is you're acknowledging that the committee memo does cite mainstream science, correct?
Yeah, absolutely, it does.
All right. And what I want to know, after we've been through this, is this. Are you standing by your position that this memo that cites mainstream science is exactly the same kind of conduct as what we've heard occurred in the Bush administration, where there was direct interference with independent conclusions reached by scientists following the scientific method?
I'll repeat exactly what I said in my written testimony. In microcosm, this shows how in political settings, which the preparation of government reports is, how easy and enticing it is to selectively present scientific results to buttress a political perspective.
Would you say there is a difference between citing mainstream science in a public memo as opposed to altering science as presented to a PR person?
Not much difference, no.
Gentlemen's time has expired. Mr. Yarmouth?
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would stipulate for the record that I'm not a scientist either, but I am a journalist by background and an editor, so I'd like to pursue a line of questioning that Mr. Shays had with Mr. Pilts. When I was editing stories, I basically looked for two things. One was whether the message was communicated clearly, and secondly, whether claims made in the article or the document were backed up by any evidence. And if I saw something that was, I suspected, might have been speculative musing or something of that nature, I would have gone to the author and asked the author to show me the documentation or the supporting or the interviews or whatever sources he or she might have had for writing that. I'm taking it from this discussion that Mr. Cooney made no particular effort to determine whether, in fact, there was something substantive behind the portions of that those reports that he excised.
That is correct.
So essentially what he did was interpose his judgment for the scientists who wrote the report.
For the career science people, yes.
Right. Dr. Griffo, you have a report coming out today and it includes some extensive interviews with about 40 government global warming scientists. I'd like to focus on one. Dr. Peter Tanz, who's the chief scientist for NOAA's Global Monitoring Division, was asked back in October of 2004 to do a press conference with the BBC, or an interview with the BBC. That was a month before the presidential election. How long did it take for Dr. Tanz to receive approval for that, to give that interview?
The interviews were not approved until February of 2005.
2005. So it took 4 months to approve.
Well, that was the approval. They actually didn't take place until even a month after that.
Is that a normal cycle for approval of an interview from a media outlet? My experience would say that would not be, that would be an extraordinarily long period of time.
That would be consistent with my experience, yes.
And just in terms of other interviews that scientists might have given, and any of you can answer, would it take 4 months for even a government agency scientist to agree to do an interview or to turn down an interview?
Is that to me, to them?
Whoever.
I can never get that. We had cases at NASA where a request would come in, say from CNN, to talk about the latest global temperature changes. Our public affairs officer would relay that to us, and by the time we got back, they would say, headquarters has already told them that nobody is available. There will not be such an interview. So that, those things did happen.
I'm sorry.
I just was letting him go first. Can I just hop
sure.
in? Back in? I mean, our report indicates a large number of those incidences happening. I mean, there's a number that are described, anonymous scientists from NOAA, Christopher Milley, Dr. Schindel's case, Richard Weatherald. I mean, there are many of these that have been documented. So it is not an isolated incident.
Were there conditions placed on the approval of the interview?
Yes, there was
a
minder. There was a public affairs officer that was required to be there, and in fact, he flew across the country and even to Mauna Loa, Hawaii, in order to be there for those interviews.
And did he serve any useful purpose, as far as you can tell?
Well,
is that standard operating procedure when a scientist is interviewed?
I think what's important here is that a scientist coordinate with the agency, that they let the agency know that an interview is taking place, and that they report back on this interview after the interview has taken place. That's what the critical role and the relationship should be between a scientist and a public affairs officer.
So basically, the taxpayers paid to send someone along all over the globe to just watch Peter Tanz give an interview.
Yes, sir, they did.
That's all I have. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Yarmouth. Mr. Eisen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're recognized for a second round.
Thank you, and thank you so much for calling this hearing. As I mentioned as a sidebar, this is at least two great hearings wrapped into one, perhaps three. So I'll try to get through just a couple more points. Mr. Peltz, my understanding is that you were a strong supporter, remain a strong supporter of the 2000 National Assessment Climate Change.
Okay. Yes.
And both you and Dr. Pelkey, I'm sure, are familiar with James Hansen.
Yes.
Okay, and you also are. Well-respected. And my understanding is he vehemently disagreed with the assessments, felt that the models were flawed, leading to overly pessimistic views, and said so in a number of writings. Is that roughly correct?
I'm not aware of Dr. Hansen's specific comments on the national assessment, but I think that every scientist had an individual opinion about how he might have done it better.
Dr. Pelkey, are you familiar with
that? I'm not familiar with him.
Okay, well, I'll quote him briefly. He said, the predicted 1% per year or 2 to 3-fold 21st century increases in CO2 assumed in the study may be pessimistic. Okay, and he goes on and does a little more than may, but it was interesting that he used may, something that sometimes people object to. That study turned into a lawsuit, and the government, this Clinton administration assessment, which you support, which James Hansen had doubts about, in fact turned out by an admission of the administration to be flawed and is no longer in widespread use. So, in a nutshell, you end up with, you can have the government do work, the science can have problems in the model, it can be questioned by a minority of the science community. It can go through, in this case, a lawsuit, and administration can recognize that, in fact, some of the assumptions or models were flawed and therefore overly pessimistic. That's the assessment I find on that. But I want to continue on, Mr. Peltz, a little bit because, you know, certainly Mr. Cooney deserves
to respond to that. It would be good.
We will. He deserves to be considered as to whether his edits were proper or not. But in your own resignation letter from June 1st, 2005, you did a fairly extensive memo, and I appreciate that. But one of the things you said on page 11 was, speaking of Cooney's edits, most of the more problematic CEQ comments were not adopted. Some were, and the damage to the document was significantly limited. Now, earlier I asked you about whether or not there was further review. If I read this correctly in your own statements, what we really have is we have an editor editing your edit and then his edits being further edited. And each of you, I'm sure, like the pride of an author, would say, I didn't like his edits. And I will mention for the record that I once had dinner with Francis Ford Coppola, and it took the entire dinner for him to tell me how rotten a job they did screwing up his great work on the Godfather series. And each of them would have been better if they just left it alone. And you don't even want to get into his idea of colorization of old films. I think the point is we're having an argument over edit, 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 when in fact science is by definition not perfect or infallible, and certainly the 2000 national assessment proves that you can have bad assumptions even in a government document. The back to Dr. Griffo, thank you. Your study, this 19% response rate, doesn't it fly in the face of OMB's own requirement for an 80% response to, in fact, to have a study be considered to be reasonable survey results? And I'll just note that a study done at the request of the Urban Institute and the United Way in June of 2003 for nonprofits found, in fact, that low rate of return raises concerns about potentially serious non-responsive bias. Claims from a survey projects with low return rates are frequently viewed with skepticism and even rejected by scholarly community. Isn't it fair to say that your organization, notwithstanding the question of the Vietnam War, if you will, that's a little old history, but your organization, which released a major study just today that had been embargoed, that reaches a strong position on global warming, is in fact an advocacy group. And moreover, the Pew Charitable Trust, which I respect a great deal, gave you $1 million to promote a commitment, getting the nation's commitment to energy efficiency and renewable energy as a cornerstone of policy. Isn't it fair to say that your organization is in fact an advocacy group, and that when we're sitting here today, what we're seeing is several advocates of positions against a question of whether the administration has a right to balance that advocacy. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
The gentleman's time has expired. I want to give Dr. Griffo a chance to respond and Mr. Piltz a chance to respond as well.
Thank you very much. Yes, sir, we are advocates for good science. That is what we are advocates for getting that information out into the public realm. And furthermore, I would say that all those other surveys that you've mentioned did not have the primary consideration that we did, which was protecting the anonymity of the scientists that we surveyed. That was paramount to us. That was absolutely incredibly important because of the chilling effect that we are all here to discuss.
Mr. Peltz, you seem to want to respond to
First of all, in the national assessment, briefly, it was not a Clinton report. It was prepared by an independent panel of eminent scientists and handed to the government without any government vetting. The Bush administration has never said anything about to criticize the national assessment, never given any intellectual or scientific rationale for what, if anything, is wrong with it. They just deep-sixed it. The National Academy of Sciences has praised it as a seminal, important, credible, exemplary study. That's the bottom line on that. As for Mr. Cooney's edits, in one report in the final technical review draft of this climate change program strategic plan, at the 12th hour, he came in and proposed more than 400 text edits in the document that, in the aggregate, would have pervasively changed the tone of the document to manufacture an enhanced sense of uncertainty. It caused so much consternation on the inside that there was a pushback from the director of the Climate Change Science Program, and a solution was negotiated at the political level that a lot of these edits would not be taken. However, the vanishing of the national assessment remained.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I'd ask unanimous consent to submit for the record the proof that the Clinton administration did, in fact, settle and that the 2000 assessment has been disregarded as a result of flaws.
The Bush administration settled.
You want to submit?
I'll submit it for the record.
You'll submit some document
for the documentation. I do believe it's the Clinton administration. I'll submit it for the record.
Well, we'll be pleased to receive whatever documents you wish to submit for the record, and then we'll make our own judgment whether it proves something or not. Thank you. Mr. Lynch?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Schindel, I just wanted to go over another specific example of political interference. Now, you have been at NASA's Goddard Institute for Space Studies for 12 years, is that correct?
Yes.
So you were there in the later 90s?
That's correct.
Back then, in the late 90s, when you completed important studies in the late 90s, did you submit press releases for distribution?
Yes, I did, many times.
Okay. Did you have any problems, such as has been described here earlier in the hearing, any problems in terms of editing of those press releases?
On the contrary, I found the comments from headquarters and the press corps to be helpful in clarifying the results.
Okay. In September 2004, you submitted a press release to announce the findings of your new study on Antarctica. You suggested a title for the press release, and I'll quote it here, "Cool Antarctica may warm rapidly this century, study finds." First of all, can I ask you, was this a significant study?
Well, as I mentioned in my oral testimony, I thought it was significant both because this was an unexplained feature of the world's temperature trends, why Antarctica was going the other way from the rest of the planet, and it's an area we worry about quite a lot for the possibility of contributing to sea level rise as the ice sheets melt. So I think that, yes, it was.
All right. And now, can I ask you, was your press release accepted?
No. It was delayed several times and then came back altered. And the title that we had, as you mentioned, that we had suggested was especially objected to. So we worked for some time on that and came up with another title which we thought might be more palatable, which was NASA scientists expect temperature flip-flop in the Antarctic. That too was rejected. And after more complaints and questions as who was editing these things without ever getting a direct response, word came back from above that the title should be Scientists Study Antarctic Climate Change, with no possibility of revision. So as you might imagine, that doesn't really attract the attention of most people. The public, you as members of Congress, you're not out there reading geophysical research letters. And if a study says, you look at climate change in Antarctica, it drew very little media interest, it didn't get out into the public debate, and I think that's harmful to informing the public debate about global warming.
Right, I just want to go back again. The phrase rapid warming was deleted and...
Yes.
And instead it just indicates scientists predict Antarctic climate changes, rather neutral, rather vague title. That's you comfortable with that title?
I was not comfortable with that. I thought it was so watered down that it would be of little interest to anybody after all the time and effort we went to make this release and communicate the results, that would do a very poor job of doing so. But when I objected, there was no response, and I was told that it had to be that title. And indeed, there was little media report.
Let me ask you quickly, press interviews. What was the procedure under the Clinton administration and in the late 90s for press interviews?
The Public Affairs Office worked to facilitate our contacts with the media, and when inquiries came into Public Affairs, they would simply relay them to us and say, do you have a chance to talk to this person? Go ahead, contact them.
Right. And what was the most recent process under the Bush administration?
In the fall of 2004, that's when they were imposed this rule that press officers, or minders, if you will, had to be present, supposedly for our benefit, to protect us from being misquoted, although there was no feeling within the agency that this was actually a problem. And instead, it had a rather chilling effect.
Gentlemen's time has expired. Mr. Murphy?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just had a few questions for Dr. Griffo. We've been talking today, obviously, about the very unique question of global warming and the impact of political decisions made in Washington upon scientific opinion. But I think we might be remiss in leaving this hearing if we didn't admit that there is a creep of political influence into other areas of this administration as well. And we certainly understand the long-term ramifications of global warming on the health of our nation, but there are more potentially immediate consequences of the political decisions made within this administration when it comes to the Food and Drug Administration. And I understand that the Union of Concerned Scientists have done some work into surveying the opinions of those working in and around the Food and Drug Administration. And I might just ask you a few questions about some of your work there to maybe educate our panel and Congress on some of the ancillary implications beyond the subject of global warming. When you did this survey of FDA scientists, it'd be interesting to know if you heard from any of those scientists that whether they were asked for non-scientific reasons to inappropriately exclude or alter any technical information or conclusions in any of the documents that the FDA was providing to Congress or to other agencies. Did you get a sense from FDA scientists whether they were asked, in essence, to censure the information that they provided for those documents?
Yes, sir, we did, in answer to the actual survey instrument that was mailed to them anonymously, again, with an anonymous return. And I would also say that the FDA scientists came back to us with 69 pages of essays, 69 pages of their own words, irrespective of the questions we asked. You know, their hearts have really been poured out into that document, and that is on our website, and we can make that available. But I would say that, you know, 145 FDA scientists had been asked to alter info or conclusions for non-scientific reasons. And I think even more frightening is that 461 of them knew of cases where commercial interests had inappropriately intruded into that process. I mean, these are the decisions that, you know, profoundly and very directly affect our health and the health of our children. I will just add that I had a personal experience with Ketek, a drug that really never should have come onto the market, and because of the manipulation of the science, did. And in fact, this was a drug that caused profound liver failure and was prescribed to my son for an infected hangnail. I mean, this is the risk that we encounter with this kind of interference.
You gave us sort of the gross numbers of those that responded. What what percentages of the respondees are you talking about that were either believed that they were forced into making decisions for commercial rather than scientific reasons, or even felt pressure? I mean, there's to the extent that people actually changed their input or changed the recommendations they were making, but then there's also simply the issue of those in the agency that felt that they were pressured to make those different decisions. Do you have a sense of what percentage of scientists answered in the affirmative to those types of questions?
Yes, and again, we went to great lengths to determine who were the scientists and made sure that they were the respondents. We had a high level of PhDs, a high level of high GS scientists responding, and a very high level of, you know, 10 and 15 years at the agency. So these were the cream of the crop, if you will. 60% knew of cases where commercial interests inappropriately induced or attempted to induce changes to FDA decisions or actions. And again, 61% of our respondents knew of cases of inappropriate political interference.
And in your experience of surveying different agencies and departments of the administration, how does that, the concern of those scientists and the pressure put upon the FDA officials and scientists. How does that compare with some of the other issues that we've been talking about today or other experiences that you've heard from other departments and agencies within the administration?
I think one of the most frightening ones has to do with a fear of retaliation, that we had 396 scientists at the Food and Drug Administration who could not publicly express concerns about that, you know, public health without fear of retaliation, and that 357 of them, that would be 36% of our respondents, could not even express those concerns within the agency. As I started off in my testimony with a total number from across the federal government, and that number was, you know, when we look at retaliation, 699 scientists, that's 39% across nine agencies, have reported that they fear retaliation for openly expressing their concerns about the mission-driven work of their agencies.
Thank you, Mr. Murphy. Your time is
expired. Thank you very much.
Mr. Braley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm very concerned that even if the White House and administration political appointees can't edit every scientific report and press release, they're sending a strong signal to government scientists that the threat of global warming should be played down and science should get as little attention as possible. And because of that, good scientists who do important research may worry about voicing their concerns or publicizing their findings. And Mr. Piltz, I'm going to start with you. Are you personally worried about the chilling effect or self-censorship that this environment breeds? And if so, can you share with us how that manifests itself in the way you and your colleagues do your work?
That is an excellent question, and I think it's a key point, really, and one I haven't had a chance to emphasize. I know I cited the marked up documents that came fairly early on as graphic illustrations of a pervasive pattern, but you know, once this heavy-handed censorship signal is sent, the career people in the federal agencies, they defer to the White House, they have their antenna out, what could be career limiting, don't rock the boat. I mean, they're great public servants, but what sets in, if you know that what you're writing has to go through a White House clearance before it can be published, people start writing for the clearance, toning down, steering away from, and a kind of anticipatory self-censorship sets in among the career federal program managers, and maybe not on the side. The FDA scientists and some of the other agencies, their scientific conclusions feed directly into regulatory decision making. So the pressure is right on their scientific conclusions. Since we don't really have a regulatory regime on climate change, the interference tends to be more with the communication that might influence the way people think about the issue. But it's the same, you know, it's an analogous dynamic. People censor themselves, and there is a chilling effect, certainly.
Thank you. Dr. Schindel, what about you? Have you seen or heard about any of your colleagues responding to expected political pressure by censoring themselves or just giving up on a press release or a press contact?
Yes, both of these things. I think that people were aware that releases would be delayed so long if they tried to talk about global warming or climate change that it was left out. I've seen people talk much more favorably about the environment at universities now, where they encourage outreach as opposed to what's going on in the federal government.
Thank you. Dr. Griffel, the Union of Concerned Scientists and the Government Accountability Project interviewed 40 government climate scientists. Were any of these scientists worried about the administration learning of their conversations with you?
Yes, and in fact, the number that the study began with was much higher. It was more than 150, almost 200 scientists. And out of that large group that were contacted for the study, we really only ended up with five or six that were willing to go on the record, a significant drop, on obviously because of their fear of retaliation or other problems.
I'm going to offer this question to the entire panel. As someone who started out in a very challenging engineering curriculum and later switched to a political science degree, one of the things I know is that the heavy emphasis on math and science oftentimes makes it impractical to educate scientists on some of the constitutional protections they have in terms of freedom of speech, freedom from interference with voicing their opinions in a setting similar to what we're talking about. And Dr. Griffel, one of the things you had talked about was the increased need for whistleblower protections, and also ensuring that scientists have a constitutionally protected right of free speech. What, if anything, do we need to be doing to educate scientists to make sure that they understand the constitutional basis for their free speech protections and arm them with the knowledge so they can be more forceful advocates to speak out and have the courage to do what's necessary to make sure that we become aware of these concerns?
I think one of the key things that we need to do is to affirmatively educate. We cannot assume that, in fact, these scientists know what these things mean. And our experience, our conversations with scientists, you know, anecdotally as well as in the essays and the other ways that we receive communications, have told us over and over that the line is gray to them. And so because of that grayness, they are taking giant steps backward from what they are actually able to do. And what, you know, we are asking for is very simply is that these things come out, that we have clear policies, we have a model media policy that's appendix to the report, which clearly lays out, you know, yes, there are roles for public affairs officers. Coordination is important. We're not saying that, you know, you don't have to play by some rules. But what we are saying very loudly, very clearly, I hope, is that you don't give up your constitutional rights when you become a federal scientist. That, in fact, there are protections in statutes that need to be communicated and enforced, and the scientists need to know where that line is so that they can be at that line and not self-censoring themselves away from it.
If I could add just one other quick point. The last four pages of my written testimony has memoranda prepared by the legal director at the Government Accountability Project on how even the NASA media policy, which is an upgrade, falls short in terms of Whistleblower Protection Act protections, anti-gag statute, and things that make it clear that scientists don't give up their freedom of speech when they become federal employees. And there are some specific issues, legislative points, raised in that, that I think I would commend to the committee's attention.
Thank you very much,
I agree with the statement of the other witnesses, and I would also like to mention that there's a second issue here. Is with NASA, for example, we do have this new openness policy, which is a great first step, but what we're seeing in the future is we may be able to communicate information, but we may not have any information, because all of the budget for Earth observations is being gradually shifted within NASA, whose budget is staying high, but it's being shifted to other areas, and it's being shifted out of science and especially out of earth science. So we're likely 5 years to 10 years from now to have far less ability to even observe our own planet than we do now.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Welch.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In February of 2006, the New York Times reported that political appointees in the NASA press office were, in fact, exerting strong pressure during the 2004 presidential campaign to cut the flow of news releases on climate change. And the article entitled Call for Openness at NASA adds to reports of pressure. And I'd like to ask that that be made part of the record, Mr. Chairman.
Without objection, that'll be the order.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Schindel, in listening to your testimony, I can't help but wonder if your personal experience is related to that broader story. And what can you tell us about your experiences with NASA in the run-up to the 2004 election? And does the Times article appear consistent with your own experience?
Well, obviously, it's difficult to know what intentions were behind policies that you didn't see formulated. But I would certainly agree that it is consistent. All of these new restrictions that I was talking about on press releases and the imposition of minders to be present at interviews, all of that took place in the fall of 2004, just before the election.
Okay. Dr. Griffo, do you have anything to add on this point?
Yeah, and not to comment on the timing, but just simply to say that, in fact, there are six categories of things that we saw and that we documented in the gap portion of the report. Press release delays, the presence of minders, you know, pre-approval for interviews and rerouting of interviews, overall decreased media contact, altering of documents, and perhaps, you know, also intimidating, really had to do with the requirement that scientists prepare Q&As. They had to anticipate what questions were going to come up in these interviews. And in fact, you might think, so what's so bad about that? Well, in fact, what was happening was that the information in those Q&As was used to actually determine whether or not the interviews were granted or to feed into that process of decision making.
Were there any sources that reported what you just described?
All of these, yes. I mean, they are, I can give you, you know, pages of documentation that we have. I mean, we have the interviews, but I think also very interestingly, a lot of this work was based on documents obtained through the Freedom of Information Act. And I think really interestingly is that in response to very broad queries about climate and climate change and, you know, very, very broad questions, we received 2,000 pages of documents, the Government Accountability Project, I should say, received 2,000 pages of documents from NOAA, 9 pages from NASA, and no pages from the EPA.
That's great. One other question. Later this week, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or the IPCC, is going to release its latest scientific assessment about our understanding of climate change science. And the IPCC, as you know, it includes hundreds of the world's finest scientists. In light of that, I noticed that the IPCC is mentioned in the CEQ documents reviewed by the committee staff. And in one document, the CEQ chief of staff, Mr. Cooney, informs another White House staffer that they'll use a controversial paper to rebut the IPCC. And in the EPA memo, an EPA staffer notices that this might be a problem, in saying that the EPA will take responsibility and severe criticism from the science and environmental community for poorly representing the science. So I want to ask the panelists, is the credibility of the IPCC in doubt? Does it make any sense for our government to seek to actively undercut this body of scientists? Dr. Griffel, perhaps you could start.
Yeah, I think what I would like to say about the IPCC is that, you know, it is one of the most extensive, transparent, you know, examples of iterative peer review. I mean, I think it is a document that has reviewers and review editors and many processes of meetings and you know, conversations in order to have this process move forward. And I think that what's really extraordinary about it is that all of the authors of each chapter must agree that all sides of the science have been fairly represented. And I think that really gets to the heart of the openness of the scientific exchange that it represents. But I think furthermore, 2,500 scientific, you know, expert reviewers, 800 contributing authors, 450 lead authors from 130 countries, 6 years of work, I think it's, you know, an amazing piece of work and will be received in that way. And I just, if I might add one other note, I want to say that there's more information. I mean, we are continuing, and the Government Accountability Project is continuing to work on this and on the documentation, and there is to be another report in about a month's time.
Okay, thank you. Briefly, yeah.
Yes, I would say that when the science community comes together and produces these comprehensive assessments, and they do have synthesis and policymaker summaries that are readily understandable, that this is what those of us who are not technical experts should use, basically. This is the well-vetted assessment. And even after we've lifted the heavy hand of censorship, there's still the matter of taking these findings, learning them, adopting them, using them, embracing them, and translating them into the appropriate policy responses.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Welch. Oh, did Dr. Schindel, did you want to add anything to the question?
On the IPCC.
Well, I would agree that this is the most authoritative document we have, and I would say that it does not exclude anybody that wants to participate. And the paper that you referred to that supposedly would undermine it, those authors are free to join in the process as well to offer their comments and criticism, mm-hmm. and their documents were taken into account with everybody else. All of the available research is evaluated, and so this is really a wonderful thing for policymakers to have everybody sit together and look and get the best evidence. The only drawback that I can see with this process is that it takes so long that by the time it comes out, some things can be out of date. And what we've seen, for example, is that the melting of Greenland has been accelerating so incredibly rapidly that the IPCC report that will come out next week will already be out of date in predicting likely sea level rise, which will probably be much worse than is projected in the IPCC report.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Welch. Mr. Yarmouth, you wish a second round.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We've heard some very disturbing testimony today about political interference in the area of climate science, but the politicization of science isn't limited under the Bush administration to climate change. We have heard all sorts of evidence in regarding endangered species and food and drug safety as well. Dr. Griffo, Union of Concerned Scientists has surveyed other scientists in the past. You have a February 2005 survey of fish and wildlife scientists that included hundreds of biologists, ecologists, and botanists. When you asked those scientists, was there evidence that they felt they had been directed for non-scientific reasons to refrain from making scientific findings that would protect endangered species?
Yes, sir. And I would say in that survey, actually, the return rate was almost 30%, so it was a higher rate, if that matters. But 44% of the endangered species scientists reported being directed for non-scientific reasons to refrain from findings protective of species. Hmm.
Were scientific conclusions reversed or withdrawn because of the business interests in any instances?
Well, what we saw that 70% of the scientists reported or knew of cases where political appointees had injected themselves into those ecological services determinations.
Based on your survey, it's clear that there was political interference and that it was widespread when it comes to science surrounding endangered species. How did this affect the outcome of policymakers and decision makers? Was there any evidence based on your survey that decision makers made decisions differently based on this suppressed science, if you will?
Well, I think there's a couple of aspects to that question. I mean, one is the self-censorship that we keep returning to. I mean, I think when I go to scientific meetings, such as my discipline, and fish and wildlife scientists come up to me, you know, they express very clearly their experiences and their hesitation to bring forward this kind of information. I think in addition to that, I mean, obviously there are things in the survey, but overall, I mean, what we've seen is a very large drop in the number of species that end up being listed. And whether or not, you know, you agree or disagree with that, the fact is that the science is not coming out. Again, there are problems with being able to publish results in peer-reviewed literature. There are problems with these basic scientific freedoms amongst the scientists at the Fish and Wildlife. And again, you know, these species are important for various reasons, and they have consequences for the American people.
Mr. Chairman, this hearing is appropriately focused on how the Bush administration officials have repeatedly tried to muzzle government climate scientists and distort their findings. We need to remember that this is part of a larger pattern of politics trumping science throughout the Bush administration. I commend you once again for holding these hearings.
Thank you very much, Mr. Yarmuth. I want to thank each of the witnesses for your presentation today. You're very distinguished scientists with a great deal of integrity. Policymakers must have good science, unfiltered, unaltered scientific information, especially when taxpayers' dollars are being used to pursue that information. And even, of course, if it's coming from the private sector, if information is being sent to us, it ought to be the information that the scientists have agreed upon. I think this hearing today will further our ability to deal with the issue of climate change, and of course the big issue before us is to get the administration to move from a confrontation to cooperation. We've been trying on a bipartisan basis for 6 months to get the information from the Council on Environmental Quality. I expect to get that information and any other information that's pertinent to the representatives of the American people. That concludes our hearing, and we stand adjourned.
I'll be right there. Good job, guys. Everybody was awesome. It's great.
Commend the members on their attention span.
Yeah.
They've never done anything like that before.
I'm sorry.
So
I need
just rather unbelievable.
Oh, yeah.
And no explanation given. And didn't seem to make
it.
Any sense.
I loved
so
it.
Why
yeah, I'd go back in a heartbeat.
Now, what's going on?
Hello. How are you?
Hey.
Thank you.
From the USGCRP
office. It's just another Italian.
You're watching Public Affairs programming on